This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends, the soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water, then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is atrager. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile in Here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you very much, Fred Foy. Hello, everybody. Welcome to The Glowing Dial once again. I'm Big John Matthews, your warm, friendly host.
And I'm not.
And, no, but what you are is Greg Barker.
Who?
Yes, filling in once again for the absent Steve Archiver Bannock, and yes, we want to have Steve back. We keep inviting him back, but he's...
And besides, Fred keeps saying so.
Yeah, exactly. And unfortunately, Fred's no longer with us, so he can't recut the opening for us. So...
Curse you, Fred.
don't curse. He was a nice man to do this for us. You know, it lends the show a lot of class, I think, still, to have Fred's voice on there in the beginning.
Thank you, Fred.
Thank you, sir. Yes, indeed. We are celebrating New Year's this time around on the Glowing Dial.
Not so loud. I have a headache.
Oh, did you imbibe too much at your party?
I wasn't imbibed to anything.
Okay.
I ate too much.
Oh, yeah. Well, people generally do that around Thanksgiving, but I guess, you know, Christmas dinners, too.
Oh, yeah, it's New Year's for me.
I've never known New Year's dinners, though. They usually just, you know, you go to parties and they have hors d'oeuvres and snacks and things, not full meals. People don't generally do, you know, turkey or goose dinners or anything like that for New Year's.
Goose.
No, I'm not going to show you where the wild goose goes. Anyway, this is a family program. Yes, indeed. We have four programs to celebrate the new year with you folks, and we're going to get started with all those and more right after this.
Perhaps the funniest series ever on radio is now available in a 14-CD limited edition package. That's all 273 episodes, plus bonus material. Yes, available at last. The complete story of Chicken Man. This is the ultimate collector's package, mastered from the original master tapes by Dick Orkin, Chicken Man's creator and voice. Aside from every Chicken Man episode ever made, this package includes interviews with key players, behind-the-scenes stories, and an official color photo, personally autographed by Chicken Man himself. And each limited edition package is individually numbered. A very naughty criminal mastermind, now a reformed swell guy, says of our hero,
"The most fantastic crime fighter the world has ever known."
An anonymous admirer says,
"He's poultry in motion."
By now you're probably asking yourself, how the heck can I get one of these neato packages? Well, simply hop online and go to glowingdial.com. Scroll down and you'll see the magnificent No Expense Spared advertisement and ordering link. Remember, this is a limited edition numbered package, so you better hurry up and order. If you don't, you might miss out. And then all I can say is, well... And we have returned. Yes, that Chicken Man set. That's just a wonderful thing. It's past Christmas, but it makes a great gift any time of year. And you're helping out the Glowing Dial by purchasing one of those. So if you click through to that page, the Dan O'Day's page, I think, there's some other Dick Orkin radio work sets, CD sets there to peruse. The Story Lady, I think, being one of them, and I really should write these down so I can tell you the other ones that are there.
We just make them up.
That's it. Make them up, yeah. No, those are the bad jokes. We just make them up, and Ringo rimshots us into another dimension with them. We have an episode of The Mysterious Traveler. Thank you. For that little bit of atmosphere there. Now, that's just bad breath there, Greg.
Anybody can have bad breath, but no, never mind.
Okay, all right. Yeah, exactly. I see why you edited that right there at that spot. It was a classic bit of George Carlin, the rest of which we don't say on this program. The episode of The Mysterious Traveler we have for you folks is called New Year's Nightmare. It's from Sunday, January 5th, 1947, originally over Mutual. It stars Maurice Tarplin, Stuart Brodé, Louise Fitch, Hester Sondergaard, and Mort Lawrence. Carl Caruso was announcing, and the show was sustained. And Greg has some more information on The Mysterious Traveler to impart to us.
I do?
You're looking right at it.
Oh, is that what that was? Yeah, all right.
All those little black squiggly things on the paper there.
Well, let's see what they say.
Those are words.
Oh, okay. Here we go. At one time or another, the mysterious traveler was heard on virtually every night of the week. There were frequent gaps between its runs, but it always seemed good for a revival. It was eternally sustained, but cheap to produce. There was no major film stars to pay, and no shortage of radio actors willing to work for union scale. Maurice Tarplin, who played the title role, conveyed good-natured menace, the kind of mischievous malevolence imparted by the Whistler or Raymond of Inner Sanctum Mysteries. Like those characters, the Traveler stood outside the stories, with a few exceptions, like when he played a Dr. Smith. He narrated and commented from some omniscient perch inside the soul of his protagonist. He came to his listeners in the night, riding a phantom train. The opening signature was that loneliest of sounds, the distant wail of a locomotive, fading in gradually until steel wheels could be heard clattering on the tracks. The stories ran from wild end-of-the-world science fiction to straight crime. Perhaps the most classic Mysterious Traveler episode was Behind the Locked Door, which was frequently requested and rerun over the years. Most Mysterious Traveler endings twisted fate and tried hard for the big surprise. The final scream blended into the train's whistle, and there was the Traveler again, clacking along on his ever-rolling journey. The Mysterious Traveler ran from December 5th, 1943 to September 16th, 1952 on Mutual and was written, produced, and directed by Robert Arthur and David Kogan, who also were known for their other shows, The Strange Dr. Weird, and The Sealed Book.
Amongst other things, they were quite a prolific writing duo. Together and apart, actually, they were quite prolific. So thank you, Greg. Thank you for that information. It's time to pull this episode out of the innards, the tar, the McGee machine.
Ew.
And it's going to be slimy. Oh, you have to get off now. I'm sorry.
Oh, yes.
But I take the same train every week at the same time. Sorry, I was possessed by the mysterious traveler for a moment there. All right, if you would manipulate the tuning dials.
Manipulate.
If I could say it right.
If I could turn the thing.
Turn that thing. Turn that thing. Do what you want to do. Sounds like a soul hit from the 70s.
Sly and the Family Stone with Turn That Thing. Sit back, folks, and close your eyes and remember the mysterious traveler. This is New Year's Nightmare from Sunday, January 5, 1947, originally over Mutual.
Presents The Mysterious Traveler.
This is The Mysterious Traveler, inviting you to join me on another journey into the realm of the strange and the terrifying. I hope you will enjoy the trip, that it will thrill you a little and chill you a little. So settle back and get a good grip on your nerves. If you can. Where are we going? Well, let us say for the moment, we're taking a little trip into time. In a story I call New Year's Nightmare. As the old year entered its last minute, the crowds at the Club Tropicana were waiting expectantly for the clock to strike midnight. At a ringside table, a lovely young woman angrily whispers to the man with her.
Chris, if you take another drink, I'll leave.
Oh, Judy, this is New Year's Eve. It'll be 1947 in another minute. Gotta celebrate, don't I? Just one more.
Just one more, just one more. That's what you always say. I wouldn't mind if it were just tonight, but you're always getting drunk.
Waiter, another bottle of champagne.
Nothing I say means anything to you, does it? You think because I've forgiven you a dozen times in the past, I'll do it again. But you're wrong, Chris.
Happy New Year, darling. 1947 is going to be our year.
No, Chris, it isn't. I won't marry a man who gets drunk in New York and wakes up the next day in another city.
Oh, Judy, what are you saying? You don't mean that. You know I love you.
Yes, Chris, you love me. But not enough to give up drinking. I'll miss you, Chris. Miss you terribly. But I know I'm doing the right thing.
Judy, don't talk like that. I couldn't live without you. You know that. Won't you?
I'm sorry, Chris. Here's your ring. Will you please take me home?
You don't have to leave. The sight of my drinking is too much for you. I'll go someplace else and do it. Martin will take you home. Happy New Year, and goodbye.
Do you mind finishing that drink, mister? 5 o'clock in the morning and I'm dead on my feet.
Sure. Sure, I'll drink up. No matter what she says.
That's right. Now you better go home and sleep it off. Good night and a happy 1947 to you.
Thanks. And the same to you. Gotta find another bar. New Year's. Gotta celebrate. Another bar across the street. Oh, gotta celebrate.
Hey, mister! Look out for that car! You gonna get run down if you don't? Look out!
My head. Oh, it feels so funny. What's that noise? Those horns.
Why, darling, it's midnight. New Year's.
Oh, my head. It's throbbing so. Where am I? How did I get here?
Why, darling, you live here.
Live here? What are you talking about?
Charles, I'd better call Dr. Smith. You look so strange. Hello?
Connect me with Dr. Smith's apartment, please.
I've never seen this place before.
Hello, Doctor? This is Blanche Arnold. Yes, it's Charles. He isn't well. Could you come to our apartment at once? Oh, thank you. Goodbye.
What do you mean, I live here? Who are you? Where am I?
I'm your wife, Charles. This is our home, don't you remember?
You're my wife. You can't be. I'm not married. What am I doing here? What's your game?
Charles, can't you remember anything about us?
What are you talking about? I never saw you before. And why do you keep calling me Charles? My name is Chris. Chris Andrews.
Chris Andrews. So that's what the initial CA stood for.
Oh, that noise out there. What are they making such a racket for?
Because it's midnight, New Year's Eve.
Midnight? New Year's Eve? But it was midnight hours ago when I left the Club Tropicana. What are you talking about?
Oh, that must be Dr. Smith. I'll answer it.
Dr. Smith? I don't know any Dr. Smith.
Oh, come in, Doctor. I'm so glad you're here. I think it's the amnesia. It seems to have left him all of a sudden. Charles? It's Dr. Smith.
I don't know him and I don't know you. And please stop calling me Charles. I told you my name is Chris Andrews.
Mm-hmm. Won't you sit down, Mr. Andrews? I'd like to talk with you for a few minutes.
What about?
Tell me, Mr. Andrews, what's the last thing you remember before finding yourself in this apartment?
Why, Judy. She and I were at the Club Tropicana, celebrating New Year's Eve.
I see.
I remember we quarreled about my drinking. I walked out on her and had a few drinks someplace else.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I can recall. Oh, my head. I've had hangovers, but I've never thought like this before. What time is it?
It's just 4 minutes after 12.
But it can't be 4 minutes after 12, New Year's Eve. That was hours ago when I left the Tropicana.
Mr. Andrews, that was New Year's Eve, 1947.
What do you mean, that was New Year's Eve, 1947?
This is New Year's Eve, 1948.
1948? What are you talking about? It's 1947.
Well, here's the morning paper. You can see the date for yourself.
Thursday, January 1st, 1948. No, it can't be. It can't be. A year gone? Just like that? But where did it go? I haven't lived it yet.
Perhaps you'd better let me clear up a few things for you.
1948?
My name is Smith. I was a resident physician until recently at the Park Hospital. While I was on duty, last New Year's Day, 1947, you were brought into the hospital seriously injured, having been run over by a car. When you recovered consciousness 5 days later, you didn't know who you were. You were a victim of amnesia.
Amnesia?
Yes, and we didn't know who you were as you had no identification papers.
But my wallet, letters...
They were gone. The only clue to your identity was a belt buckle with the initials C.A. on it.
We didn't know your real name, so I called you Charles, for the C.
Blanche was your nurse.
I've always liked the name Charles. And as for your last name, we thought Arnold was as good as any, so you became Charles Arnold.
But what have I been doing since the day I recovered consciousness?
Well, you weren't discharged from the hospital until May. Then you went to work as an insurance clerk.
As an insurance clerk? But I don't know anything about being a clerk. I'm a reporter.
Well, there was no way of learning what your occupation had been. So when Blanche learned of this opening in an insurance office, you applied for the position.
And that's where I've been working up to now?
Yes.
And then after you got your job, we were married.
Married?
Charles, I mean, Chris, don't you remember?
I'm afraid, Blanche, you really can't.
Married. But Judy, oh, it's like a dream. My head keeps throbbing. I keep expecting to wake up. There's that date in the paper, January 1st, 1948.
Doctor, you said he might never get over his amnesia.
Well, that was a strong possibility, but apparently the sounds of New Year's brought back his memory.
You're gone just like that. Judy. My friends. Job. All gone. Doctor, where am I? I mean, what's the address of this apartment house?
You're at 5718 North 13th Street. Philadelphia.
Philadelphia? But how did I get to Philadelphia?
That we don't know. All that I can tell you is that your accident occurred just a few blocks from here.
Darling, I know what a shock it must...
Strange. You must have called me darling many times in the past. And yet this is the first time I've ever heard you call me that.
Yes. I know.
What did you say your name was?
Oh, hello, Doctor. Come in, won't you?
Thank you. How are you, Blanche?
All right, I suppose.
How's Chris getting along?
He's fine. It's just...
Why, Blanche, what's this? I've never seen you cry. Here, here.
No, it's just that everything's so changed. Those 6 months Chris and I were married before he regained his memory were the happiest of my life.
And now?
This past month since he got his memory back, it's been as though I were married to a stranger. It isn't as though he doesn't try to be nice to me. But it's also obvious. He doesn't love me.
Now, Blanche, you mustn't say that.
It's true, I tell you. How can a man love a woman those first 6 months as he loved me and then fall out of love with her when he's regained his memory?
You must have patience, Blanche. It will take time for Chris to adjust himself to what's happened. He fell in love with you as Charles Arnold, and I'm sure he will as Chris Andrews. You just must give him time. Judy!
Oh.
Oh, Judy. Oh, just let me look at you. Oh, this can't be true. You're being here.
Well, it is. It's been a long time.
Yes. Year and a month since New Year's Eve, 1947.
Chris, what are you doing here in Philadelphia?
I live here.
Well, so do I. I got a job with Ryan and Company as a copywriter here a few months ago.
Look, Judy, we can't talk here on the sidewalk.
That's right. I live only a few blocks from here. We can go to my apartment.
Oh, that's fine. There's so much I want to ask, and there's so much to tell.
Here, let me have your hat and coat.
Thank you.
Would you like something to drink?
No, I don't drink anymore.
Chris, you have changed. You look so much older.
Oh, you don't. You're as lovely as that night I saw you last.
Thank you, Chris.
Judy, you'll have to let me explain what happened after I left you that night at the Tropicana. If you find it difficult to believe, I won't blame you. It still seems like a nightmare to me. That night, after I left you... And so now you know everything. From the moment I last saw you to this one.
Oh, no wonder you look different after having gone through an experience like that. Well, you're all right now. You know who you are. You're happily married. You have a job.
I'm not happily married, Judy.
Chris, you mustn't talk like that. Surely you must have loved your wife if you married her. And she hasn't changed.
Judy, there's never been anyone for me but you. You know that. And you still feel that way about me?
No, I don't.
When we met tonight, that old look was still in your eyes. You do care. You know you do.
Please, Chris, no matter how I feel about you, it's over now. You're married, and that's all there is to it. I wish you'd go, and I don't want to see you again.
Where have you been?
expected you home from work hours ago.
I met a friend.
Oh. Well, you look so tired. Do you feel well?
Blanche, this past month I tried my best to be a good husband, haven't I?
Well, you have been, darling.
No, there's something missing and you know it. Oh, it isn't your fault, it's mine. And as a result, we're both unhappy.
You mustn't say that, Chris. I feel that in time, things will be as they were when we were first married. When you were Charles Arnold.
No, but they won't be, Blanche. It's no use, I tell you.
Chris, who is the friend you met tonight?
The girl I was once engaged to.
I see.
Blanche, you've got to give me a divorce.
No, Chris. I'll never do that.
But why? You know I don't love you. What's the sense in going on like this?
Chris, when you were Charles Arnold, you did love me, and we were happy together. I had your love once, and I mean to win it back. I won't give you a divorce.
Hello, Judy.
Chris. Chris, I asked you not to call on me again.
Judy, I've got to talk to you. May I come in?
Well, all right. But just for a few minutes.
Thank you. Judy, even if we hadn't met again a week ago, things wouldn't have been any different between my wife and myself. I'll never love her. And I'm not going on with her.
What do you mean, Chris?
I'm going to leave her, Judy, and start all over, someplace far away. I just came around to say goodbye.
Are you set on leaving her?
Yes. Nothing can change my mind about that.
Now, you've got to understand my position, Chris. I could never be happy with you if I thought I'd been the one who came between you and your wife. But if you are going to leave her, I would like to see you again when you're free.
Would you, Judy?
Yes. But I don't want to see you until she's given you a divorce.
A divorce? Judy, I am going to be free. Nothing's going to prevent it. Nothing. Blanche, how would you like to go out tonight?
Go out?
Yeah, we might take in a show or go dancing. Didn't I ever take you out when I was Charles Arnold?
Why, yes. We used to have wonderful evenings together then.
Well, why not now? Unless you don't want to.
Oh, Chris, there's nothing in the world I'd rather do.
Hey, why the tears?
Oh, it's just that I'm so happy.
Oh, come here. Did this Mr. Arnold ever put his arms around you like this?
Oh, yes, often. Oh, Chris, stop squeezing me so tight. Chris!
Sorry, darling.
Oh. Oh, you almost squeezed me to death.
That's so you'll remember that I'm your husband and not Mr. Arnold. And Blanche.
Oh, yes, Chris.
I'm taking a week's vacation soon, what do you say if we go up to the Adirondack Mountains for a week of winter sports?
Oh, Chris, I'd love to. Well, it'll be like a second honeymoon.
Blanche, you all right? It's only a few more feet to the top.
I'm coming, darling. Where are you? Oh, there you are. Oh, Chris. Oh, the view is wonderful from here, isn't it?
You're right. Being up here is like being alone in the world.
Yes, just the two of us. Oh, this past week's been a wonderful one, Chris. I've never been so happy.
Nor have I.
Oh, be careful, Chris. Don't go so near the edge. That canyon's 4,000 feet deep.
Oh, this ledge is perfectly safe. Come over here and take a look at the valley below.
All right. Ooh, please keep your arms around me, Chris. Looking down like this frightens me.
There. You're safe in my arms.
Chris, why are you looking at me that way?
What way, dear?
I don't know. Is your head throbbing again?
No, dear. I don't suppose you've changed your mind about giving me a divorce, have you?
Giving you a divorce? But I thought we were so happy together.
Yes, that's the impression I meant people to get.
Chris, you can't be serious. Why, everything's been wonderful these past few weeks.
Oh, I see it won't be any use trying to talk you into it.
What do you mean?
I'm sorry, Blanche. I don't want to do this, but you've given me no alternative. It's really your own fault, that you must die.
Let go of me.
No, you strutting, darling. No one can see or hear you, and you can't possibly escape.
You can't throw me off that ledge, then I'll hang you.
I don't think so, dear. We've been so happy these past few weeks, I'm sure the police will see it as an unfortunate accident.
Stop pushing me toward the edge, Chris. Don't, no, I'll give you a divorce. I'll give you anything.
I'm afraid it's too late for that. Good evening, Judy. May I come in?
Why, yes, of course. How are you, Chris?
Oh, I'm all right. I want to thank you for the note you sent me when Blanche died.
I can't tell you how sorry I was to hear about it, Chris.
Yes, it all happened so quickly. Mm.
What have you been doing since then?
Oh, just working. Trying to straighten myself out.
Yes.
Judy, perhaps I shouldn't talk about it now, seeing that Blanche has only been gone a month, but I've been thinking of leaving town. Would you come with me?
Please sit down, Chris. You make me nervous walking back and forth like that.
All right. But you haven't answered my question.
Well, it isn't easy to answer.
Well, it would be if you said yes. I see in your eyes you mean no. Why?
Chris, I've met someone else recently.
Someone else? But you said if I were free, you'd marry me.
I didn't say I'd marry you. I said if you were free, I'd like to see you again. But now I'm not even sure of that. You're so different from what you used to be.
Stop being clever. If you didn't say you'd marry me, you implied as much.
Please, Chris, you're making it so difficult for me.
I'm making it difficult for you. And I suppose what I've been through doesn't count. I risked my life to get you.
Risked your life? Chris, what are you saying?
Are you such a fool as to believe that Blanche fell off that mountain?
Chris, you didn't.
Yes. And I didn't because you said you'd marry me if I were free.
Oh, no, I meant a divorce.
But she wouldn't give me a divorce. It was the only way I could gain my freedom. And now you tell me there's someone else.
Oh, Chris.
I did it for you. And you're going to marry me.
No, I won't.
If I can't have you, no one else will.
Chris, what's the matter with you? Chris!
We were meant for each other, darling. In life and in death.
Chris, if you come any closer, I'll scream for help. No, don't. Chris, no!
You won't marry me. You'll never marry
anyone
else. There. He'll never have you.
Oh, Mama, there.
I didn't want to do it, darling. But you forced me to. Oh, my head. It throbs so. Everything's like a nightmare.
Open up in there. This is the police.
The police? I've got to get away. Oh, they're closing in on me. There's no escape from this roof.
Let's work our ways out from this end of the roof to the other.
They'll never take me alive. Never. I've got 5 bullets. 4 for them and the last for myself.
Take it easy now, Joe. You may be hiding behind one of those chimneys.
Oh, my head. It keeps throbbing so. If I could only think. All this can't be real. It's like a horrible dream. They're coming for me.
Wait. There's someone behind that chimney over there. Get under cover.
They'll never take me alive, never. I'll show them.
Keep down, Mike.
Why don't you come and get me?
Better shoot it out with me, huh? I'll show you!
Come on, Mike. His gun is empty.
Oh, empty. You'll never take me alive. Never!
He's climbing up on the ledge. It's 15 stories down.
I'm coming, Judy! I'm coming!
He's going to jump!
I'm falling! Falling! You'll never take me. Never! I'm falling. Falling.
Doctor, the patient's recovering consciousness.
Yes, you're right. He's opening his eyes.
Oh, my head. It throbs so. Where am I? Oh, it was a dream. Not real. Oh, thank heaven.
Now, you must be quiet. You've been in a serious accident.
Accident?
Yes. You were hit by an automobile New Year's morning. Would you mind telling me your name? There weren't any identification papers in your clothing, and we'd like to inform your relatives of what's happened.
My name? It's... I can't remember my name.
I see. Well, what about your address? Can you remember that?
No. No, I can't remember anything.
Now, you mustn't get excited. It'll all come back to you. You received a fractured skull from the accident.
There was a mountain.
Mountain? You mean you live near one?
I don't know. There was a mountain, and the police were chasing me. And I jumped off a high building. It's all mixed up.
You probably dreamed that while you were unconscious. But you're all right now. Just need rest and quiet.
Where am I?
You're in the Park Hospital, Philadelphia.
Philadelphia? What day is it?
It's January 5th, 1947. It's 7:26 in the evening.
And you don't know my name?
No, all we have is your belt buckle with the initials C.A.
C.A.
Nurse, will you look after the patient now? I'll be in to see him later tonight.
Yes, doctor. Are you comfortable?
The initial C.A. What do you suppose they stand for?
Perhaps the C is for Charles?
Charles? Charles. I don't know.
Well, suppose I call you Charles, just for the time being. I always liked the name Charles.
All right. What's your name?
I'm Miss Thompson, but you can call me Blanche. And Charles, let me be the first to wish you a happy 1947.
This is the mysterious traveler again. Have you enjoyed our little trip?
Oh, by the way, I want to wish you all a very happy new year. And I do hope you'll be careful about making new acquaintances. And perhaps you'd better keep an eye on the old ones, too. For after all, who can foretell the future? Not even Chris Andrews, or should I say Charles Arnold, knows what's in store for him. But we do, don't we?
And speaking of the future, I... Oh, you're getting off here. I'm sorry.
But I'm sure we'll meet again.
I take this same train every week at this same time.
You've just heard The Mysterious Traveler, a series of dramas of the strange and terrifying. In tonight's cast were Maurice Tarplin, Stuart Brody, Louise Fitch, Hester Sondergaard, and Mort Lawrence. Original music was played by Doc Whipple. The Mysterious Traveler is written and directed by Bob Arthur and David Cogan. Listen next week over most of these stations to a tale titled
No Grave Can Hold Me.
Another tale of The Mysterious Traveler. The Mysterious Traveler has been presented from our New York studios. Carl Caruso speaking. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
Hi, this is Frank Brzee, Little Beaver on Old Time Radio's Red Rider. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve. We are back with you once again, folks. We hope you enjoyed The Mysterious Traveler. That was New Year's Nightmare from Sunday, January 5th, 1947, originally over Mutual.
It was very mysterious.
Yes, indeed. Took a lot of training to do an episode like that. Yeah, thank you, Ringo. Thank you.
Thank you, Ringo.
He's looking and he's very begrudgingly at us, like, you know, I gave that one to you. Don't ask for too much. Anyway, we have three more shows in the New Year's vein.
We're picking up steam.
Yes, to bring you here on the Glowing Dial. We're going to get to those right after these all-important words. Hi, Big John here to tell you about the greatest internet experience you'll ever have. And I'm talking about the Glowing Dial page. And to get there, all you have to do is simply point your browser to www.glowingdial.com. It couldn't be any easier. The Glowing Dial page is the internet presence for our old-time radio show, The Glowing Dial. There are so many things to see and do at the Glowing Dial page, we don't have time to list them all. But here's a few. Read mini bios of Steve, Stu, and myself and find out how the show came to be. Enter our latest contest and win a neat prize. Visit the photo gallery and view images of myself, Stu, and Steve, as well as some of our friends and OTR celebrities, too. Stop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Subscribe to our new podcast and also enjoy classic episodes of The Glowing Dial. You can also subscribe to our blog and discussion list and keep up with all the latest Glowing Dial news and information. Stop by the Glowing Dial online store and purchase a wide variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. All that and more awaits you at the Glowing Dial page at www.glowingdial.com. See you there. It's Big John and Greg, and we're back at you again. It is time, we're celebrating New Year's, of course, but it's time for that, quote, that celebratory portion of the program, the segment that Greg looks forward to. He just, you know, sitting on that bus ride all the way out here, he's thinking, I can't wait to get in front of that microphone and do this segment.
Dude, you're high.
And now back to reality. It's time for the celebrity birthdays, folks. And we have the Gandrew sisters standing by at the one mic that we provide for them. And one day we might get you all three of you, you know, your own mics, but...
Or Fred's, or Bill's, or Harry's.
Right, right. We'll have to have those probably donated to us, like this wonderful mixer was. And thank you to our...
Who donated that wonderful mixer?
They wish to remain anonymous.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
Yep.
Well, Anonymous. Hey, Anonymous. Thanks, dudes.
His name is Anonymous. Yes.
Thanks, A.
Thanks, A. Are you a Canadian?
A.
Now we've just offended Canadians. Never mind. Hey, if Bob and Doug McKenzie didn't offend you, we can't either, so.
How's it going, eh?
All right. Ladies, are you ready for the musical? Yeah, okay, you are. All right, then. Take it away. Ladies and gentlemen, on the Glowing Dial, it is time once more for the celebrity birthday list here with that thankless, arduous task. Is the man himself, Mr. Greg Barker. Take it away, sir.
All right. Now, these are birthdays are from December 27th through January 16th. Starting on the 27th, we have Oscar Levant, pianist from Information Please and Kraft Music Hall. On the 28th, we have comedian actor Cliff Arquette from Mert and Marge. On the 29th, we have announcer Wendell Niles from The Bob Hope Show, Man Called X, and Hollywood star Playhouse. On the 30th, we have actor Ed Jerome from Blackstone, The Magic Detective, and Rich Man's Darling. On the 31st, we have actor Richard Colmar from John's Other Wife and Boston Blackie. On the 1st, January 1st, we have orchestra leader Lou Kosloff from Blondie, Sad Sack, and Sherlock Holmes. On the 2nd, we have singer Julius LaRosa from Arthur Godfrey Time. On the 3rd, we have actor Ray Milland from Meet Mr. McNutley. On the 4th, we have actor Sterling Holloway from Railroad Hour, Suspense, and Lux Radio Theater.
Oh, poo. Continue, sir.
Okay. On the 5th, we have Alfred Ryder, actor from The Goldbergs and Easy Aces. On the 6th, we have Danny Thomas, actor from Bickerson's and Fanny Bryce Show. On the 7th, we have Alan Napier, actor for Campbell Playhouse and Batman on TV. On the 8th, Roger Bauer, from announcer for Can You Top This? And Stop Me If You Heard This One. On the 9th, we have John Dunning, writer for On the Air, the Encyclopedia of Old Time Radio. On the 10th, we have Anzi Strickland, actress for The Fat Man, The Shadow, and Brownstone Theater. On the 11th, it's Gene Baker, announcer for Lum and Abner and Queen for a Day. On the 12th, it's Sarah Berner, and she was an actress for the Jack Benny program. On the 13th, actor Robert Stack for Family Theater, Lux Radio Theater, and Scream Guild Theater. On the 14th, it's actor William Bendix, Life of Riley. On the 15th, we have comedian writer Goodman Ace for Easy Aces. And on the 16th, we have actor Sid Silvers for Phil Baker's Show and the Jack Benny program.
Oh my God, and that's, we had some extra musical accompaniment.
I'm so sorry. That's my phone.
Well, let's let the girls finish here. Okay, sir, we have some business to take care of here now, and we're going to do it on the air. You heard some extra little tinkling there.
Sorry. That was my phone, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, that is his phone going off.
That says it's 11 o'clock with the time here.
Yes, it's late as we record this, folks.
Can you tell?
We're staying up late just for you. Yes. So that was the celebrity birthday list with music from the Candrews sisters
and
Greg's
phone.
Telephone. Yes. Hope you enjoy that extra little tinkling in there. I kind of wondered where that was coming from at first, you know? Anyway.
I was waiting for you to go, cut.
You were getting along pretty well there.
I tried to ignore it.
So after Sterling Holloway, I said, poo. I didn't mean to, totally cut you off.
It threw me a bit. It's
Sterling Holloway was the voice of Winnie the Pooh.
Oh, okay.
The original voice of Winnie the Pooh, yeah. And there's some other I used to do that to Steve all the time during the birthday list. I would always heckle him during the birthday list. And he just kept right on going. He didn't let it bother him.
And I didn't run out of music. That's
exactly. Your phone kept providing it.
I know. Could we recovered?
Okay. All right. We have an episode, folks, of the Milton Berle Show now for you. And this is Milton Berle Salutes the New Year from Tuesday, December 30th, 1947. And a big cast on this one. It's Milton Berle, Pert Kelton, Mary Shipp, Arthur Q. Bryan, Jack Albertson, Arnold Stang, Ed Begley, Billy Sands, Charlie Irving, Johnny Gibson, Dick Forney, Ray Block and his orchestra, and Frank Gallup is announcing. The sponsor was Philip Morris. Greg, you have some information on the Milton Berle Show.
I certainly do. Well, he was actually born Milton Berlinger, and he was born on July 12th, 1908. His mother began pushing his talents when he was still a toddler. She would remain his most enthusiastic advocate throughout his career. He entertained in the streets as a boy, worked his way through the vaudeville ranks, and gravitated naturally into radio. But his act was slapstick, and few comics had ever found a way to make that work on radio. His style was not unlike Bob Hope's. He would fire off gags like a verbal machine gun, hitting targets in every direction, but missing a lot as well. He would swap insults with the announcers, mug for the studio audience, and use any joke, no matter how old, that had a potential for a laugh. According to a current biography, he came to the conclusion that jokes were public property, and over the years, he had collected at least 50,000 of them, committed most to memory. That many of these had been created by other comics didn't seem to worry him a bit. Walter Winchell dubbed him the thief of bad gags. Bob Hope told a Time reporter that, "When you see Burl, you're seeing the best of anybody who has ever been on Broadway. I want to get into television before he uses up all my material." The Milton Berle Show was one of a half dozen titles showcasing Berle in his star-crossed radio career. He was radio's best-known failure, never able to mount a decent ratings despite numerous attempts in many formats over a 13-year span. From 1934 to 36, Berle was heard regularly on the Rudy Valley Hour, and he attracted publicity as a regular on the Gillette Original Community Sing on CBS from September 6, 1936 to August 29, 1937. In 1939, he was the host of Stop Me If You Heard This One. In the late 40s, he canceled well-paying nightclub appearances to expand his radio career. Three Ring Time, a comedy variety show sponsored by Ballantine Ale, was followed by a 1943 program sponsored by Campbell's Soups. The audience participation show, Let Yourself Go, could best be described as slapstick radio. Kiss and Make Up on CBS featured the problems of contestants, decided on by a jury from the studio audience, with Berle as the judge. Berle also made guest appearances on many comedy variety radio programs during the 1930s and 1940s. Scripted by Hal Block and Martin Ragaway, the Milton Berle Show brought Berle together with Arnold Stang, later a familiar face as Berle's TV sidekick. Sponsored by Philip Morris, it aired on NBC from March 11, 1947 until April 13, 1948. The Texaco Star Theater followed and aired on ABC from September 22, 1948 to June 15, 1949, which served as a springboard for Berle's emergence as television's first major star. Berle later described this series as the best radio show I ever did. A hell of a funny variety show.
So nothing remains but for us to bring this episode to you, and that means we need our friend the McGee Machine.
We got it.
Right here between us.
Right here on this in this studio.
Some people say nothing can come between us, but the McGee Machine does.
And we crank her up.
Very good. All right, folks. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember the Milton Berle Show. This is Salutes the New Year, from Tuesday, December 30th, 1947, originally over NBC.
No mistake, of all leading cigarettes, one and only one is recognized by eminent nose and throat specialists as definitely less irritating. That one cigarette is Philip Morris. Johnny presents the Milton Berle Show. Here comes Johnny, ladies and gentlemen, to remind you, if every smoker knew what Philip Morris smokers know, they'd all change to Philip Morris. Yes, they'd all...
Philip Morris! From Radio City in New York, here is the Milton Berle Show with Herb Kelton, Jack Albertson, Johnny Gibson, Mary Shipp, Billy Sands, Charlie Irving, our singing star Dick Farney, the music of Ray Block and his orchestra, and yours truly, Frank Gallup. Ladies and gentlemen.
Great material.
Tonight we salute the new year. In just 24 hours, we'll all start the new year with a big bang.
That's right.
We now bring you a comedian who starts every Tuesday night with a dull thud. And here he is, Milton Berle.
Thank you and good evening. Gosh, we have an audience. How'd you get here? Dog sled? Much obliged. Boy, Mr. Gallup, how about that blizzard, huh? How about the blizzard? It's going to cost New York $7 million to remove the snow. Well, that's ridiculous. Just bring the bookies back and they'll clean out the city in 20 minutes. You know, Mr. Gallup? Oh, you do. You're Mr. Gallup.
No, I'm not.
Fool tonight. You know, Mr. Gallup, at the height of that record snowstorm, in the midst of that terrible blizzard, I only thought of one thing. One thing in a crisis like this. I wanted to be near my mother.
Your mother?
Yeah, she's in Florida. Oh. Really, she got her old job back as lifeguard. But that's... But Mr. Gallup, there's also the bright side to this record snowstorm. My brother Frank is working again.
Really? Yeah. What does he do?
Oh, he's got a big job. He feels the lumps in the snow and tells you which car is yours. Well, Mr. Gallup, that blizzard was brutal. Only the subways were running. In New York, I had two choices of dying. Freezing or squeezing. Freezing or squeezing. Everything else is still buried in the snow. That joke they had to dig up. How do you like it?
I don't like it.
You don't?
But now, remember...
You can easily be replaced, you know.
He has a conflict.
To the listeners that are listening in, may I explain what the conflict is? That means when a radio performer has another position and cannot make the one that we want him for. You're through. Next act. Mr. Gallup, now please.
All right, sir.
The blizzard is over,
you know.
Yes,
it's all over, and tonight we're discussing the new year.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. How true, Mr. Gallup? I led you into that pretty good, didn't I? Yes. Mr. Gallup, I still haven't made any plans for the New Year's Eve. Do you know anyone who's getting together a party?
Yes, Henry Wallace.
You're getting to be a regular park your carcass. That was pretty good.
For this program, yes.
Now watch that, Mr. Gallup. After all, this program is your bread and butter. Excuse me. For you, it's your rye crisp and anchovy paste. What are you doing New Year's Eve?
Oh, we're having our traditional festival at my club, the Pelham Bay Friends of Yella Pestle.
Yella Pestle?
Mm-hmm.
I see. Festival?
Yes, oh, it's a beautiful gesture.
Nice gesture.
Lovely. Led by Asha Heifetz, Jose Iturbe, and Arturo Toscanini, they all gather on the poop deck of the Staten Island Ferry.
The Staten Island Ferry?
Yes, and just at the stroke of midnight, they welcome the new year with the world's greatest music.
Gee. Heifetz, Iturbe, Toscanini, they must be good.
Good? Why, last year they made $8 in tips alone.
All those big musicians playing on a ferry boat? Wait until Petrillo hears about it.
Petrillo?
Yeah.
Who do you think passed around the hat?
Oh. Mr. Gallup, that story was positively bewitching. And in a minute, our listeners will be wishing they were listening to a different program. So on with our salute to the new year. But first, let us review the old year as we present the highlights of 1947.
Music. 1947's award to the outstanding figure in the world of music went to a courageous, patient woman who had nothing to do with music. She had to listen to it.
Hats off to Mrs. Harry Truman. Sports highlights. No. I'll tell you when. Sports highlights of 1947.
Baseball.
New York Yankees defeat Brooklyn for the World Series.
football.
Notre Dame and Michigan voted nation's top teams.
Boxing.
The Lewis Walcott heavyweight championship fight.
But it was in the field of radio that the most startling event of 1947 took place. In March 1947, as it must to all comedians who pester a sponsor long enough, a radio program was given to Milton Berle. Two versions of how this unbelievable event took place have been circulated. Here is Milton Berle's version of how he came to have this program. Our scene opens as Berle enters the office of the Philip Morris Company.
Well, gentlemen, here I am.
Oh, Mr. Berle.
I can't believe it. It's Mr. Berle in person.
Good evening, Mr. Philip. Good evening, Mr. Morris.
Oh, gosh, look at that coat. It's mink.
Yes, mink. Well, it was raining today, you see.
I can't get over it. The great Milton Berle coming to see little old us.
I just happened to be in the building. I'm being fitted for a new money belt. I received your frantic wires. Tell me, what is it?
Mr. Berle, sir, won't you let us sponsor you on the radio?
Radio? Where's my coat?
Mr. Berle, please, wait.
Gentlemen, I'm tired of having to say no to my sponsors and to all you sponsors. Go on the radio. You're asking me to give up my polo with Daryl Zanuck, my yachting with Guy Lombardo, parties with Johnny Myers. For what?
Money.
Money. Where's my coat?
Mr. Berle!
Money, gentlemen. I have so much money, I knew who Miss Hush was and never even bothered to mention it. Sorry, not interested.
You'll broadcast from a Mother of Pearl studio with rhinestone microphones.
We'll hire Bob Hope, Pippa McGee, and Fred Allen as your stooges.
Gentlemen, gentlemen, I said no.
But radio needs Milton Berle.
Gentlemen.
America needs Milton Berle.
Gentlemen.
Radio is crying for a man with your talent, your magnetic personality, your charm.
Gentlemen.
For the kiddies, you're cute, kindly, generous, beloved.
Gentlemen.
For the men, you're a rugged, unswerving leader.
Gentlemen.
For the women, you're romantic, gracious, handsome.
Oh, gentlemen, you're terrible.
Then you'll let us sponsor you.
Oh, all right.
Philip Morris has done it again.
It's awful how I can be talked to anything. Into anything. Don't go away. Didn't get that. It's awful how I can be talked into anything.
That was Milton Berle's version of how he came to be sponsored. Here is the other version. The truth.
Excuse me, gentlemen.
Berle!
Yeah.
We left orders to keep you out of the building.
How did you get in here this time?
I told him I was Johnny's father. Gentlemen, please.
No more handoffs.
I'll beat it, you bum.
Would you just let me stay for a minute? I just came in here to change the newspapers in my shoes. Please.
Get out. We're busy.
We have a half hour of radio time on NBC Tuesday night and no program to put on.
Gosh, well, how about putting me on the air?
You, Berle?
Berle on the air?
Ridiculous, isn't it? Well, goodbye, gentlemen.
No, wait. Say, maybe he's right. What can we lose? Let's put him on.
Philip!
You're right. We have nothing now.
Morris.
Yes, but with Berle, we'll still have nothing.
Philip.
For the first year, he'll work for Button.
Morris!
After that, we'll give him a zipper.
Philip!
What can we do? We're stuck.
Morris!
But sponsoring Berle, how do you feel about it?
Philip?
I don't know. How about you?
Morris?
Oh, let's do it.
Philip!
Okay, we'll do it.
Morris!
It's a risk.
What can we lose?
Philip Morris.
Can't go through with it.
Philip!
Wait!
Morris!
Philip Morris cigarettes have been put through every test, and we think we've got the best cigarette in the world, right?
Right.
Let's sponsor Berle and put Philip Morris through the acid test.
You mean?
If people listen to Berle and still buy Philip Morris cigarettes, then we know we've got the best cigarette in the world. Okay, Berle.
You're hired.
Morris! Philip!
From New York to California, from Louisiana to Oregon, from city after city all over the country, eminent nose and throat specialists make this report. Listen.
We are convinced Philip Morris is definitely less irritating than any other leading cigarette. That's why in cases of irritation due to smoking, we suggest change to Philip Morris.
Yes, that's professional advice and good advice to every man or woman who smokes. Change to Philip Morris. Because the cigarette that gives you the least irritation is the cigarette that gives you the most enjoyment. And after all, it's pleasure, deep, rich pleasure that counts in smoking. And the full measure of smoking pleasure is yours to enjoy day in, day out in Philip Morris. That's why we say, if every smoker knew what Philip Morris smokers know, they'd all change to Philip Morris, America's finest cigarette.
There's a great day coming, banana.
Manana. Thank you. Very nice. That was a great day coming, manana, played by Ray Block and the Philip Morris Orchestra. And Ray, old pal, I want to tell you something, Ray. I want to tell you something. We've been together for over a whole year. I'm not going to make a speech about what I think of you and your orchestra, but I can just say it in two words. No improvement. And now, as we continue our salute to the new year, we present...
New Year Forum tonight. New Year Forum tonight. The question... Should you kiss your wife at the stroke of midnight, or should you stay sober?
Thank you, Mr. Gallup. Now, let's have questions from the audience. All right, this young man in the third row wearing the General Myers button. Young man, step up to the microphone and tell me, what is your name?
My name is Oldsmobile.
Oldsmobile?
When I was born, my father was expecting a car.
Oh, I see what you mean.
They delivered me FOB.
FOB?
Full of bromo seltzer.
Full of bromo seltzer?
At the hospital, they forgot to burp me.
All right. Now, Oldsy, you have a question concerning the new year.
I got a lot of questions concerning the new year, so what?
Well, I thought...
What, are you a fortune teller? You can tell what's going to happen?
No, I just
thought... What's that on your shoulders, a head or a crystal ball?
No, look, I...
Okay, Drew Pearson, get out your tea leaves. I got some questions.
All right, but we...
Answer this one. Why don't you make it a happy new year and get off the air?
Now, wait a
Answer
minute.
Answer this
you...
one. When are you going to unravel that long, flapping tongue and tell a joke?
Now, look, you
Answer
little...
Answer this one. Who's going to listen to you in 1948 besides your mother?
Please.
Your mother's portable.
We must maintain order at our forum. Let us hear now from the ladies. All right, this lady in the red sun suit and the blue goose pimples. What is your name, madam, please?
Tallulah Feeney. I'm a homemaker.
I see. And you have a question that has to do with the new year.
Yeah, how can I keep my husband sober New Year's Eve? When the old year passes out, so does he.
Your husband likes to drink New Year's Eve?
He's very sentimental. At exactly 12 o'clock, he always drinks champagne out of my shoe.
He drinks champagne out of your shoe?
Yeah, that's why he makes me wear paratrooper's boots.
I see what you mean.
Last year we had a party and he mixed the punch. He sure put a kick in it.
He put a kick in it?
Yeah, he stirred it with his foot.
Mrs. Feeney!
Oh, he put his galoshes on first.
Oh, I didn't know.
What, do you think he's a slob or something?
No. That's different.
He's always dropping into bars. He says he just wants to wet his whistle.
Just wants to wet his whistle?
Yeah, the trouble is he never knows when it's time to blow.
I understand.
Last New Year's Eve, he ran out of liquor. He finally found a full glass.
He did?
Yeah, but that drink ruined him. For months, he couldn't eat a thing.
What was in the glass?
His teeth.
Thank you, Mrs. Feeney. Thank you. And now, as a fitting climax to our forum, we bring you a man who has just been selected the Man of the Year. It is an honor to present that rugged Adonis, that perfect specimen of American manhood, Big Mike Featherfield. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Featherfield.
Thank you, Mr. Barrow. This is indeed a golden opportunity for thanking my many fans who have seen my pictures in magazines and have sent me such wonderful letters asking, what is it?
It's wonderful. Out of the thousands of contestants, you were chosen the Man of the Year.
Yes, and I owe it all to one thing, Mr. Burroughs.
What's that?
All the other contestants were women.
I understand that you stand a good chance of also being selected as Life Magazine's Man of the Year.
How about that?
Were you interviewed for Life?
Yes.
What happened?
They didn't find any.
Mr. Featherfield, what was your prize-winning achievement that made you the man of the year?
Mr. Burl, I single-handedly removed the most frightening menace facing the men of America.
How did you do it?
I married her.
Oh, your wife. Well, how is your wife? In good health?
Yes. Discouraging, isn't it?
Mr. Featherfield, you mean your wife mistreats you?
Mr. Burl, when she beat me up last night, she had a reason.
Mr. Featherfield, you've been bad again.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me, what did you do?
Well, last night...
Yeah.
Oh, I shouldn't be telling you this.
Oh, come on. It's New Year's. Tell us what happened.
Well, last night she caught me with the light on in my room after 8:30.
Yeah. Wait a minute. But 8:30 isn't late.
Well, you don't understand. She'd already blown taps.
Thank you, Mr. Featherfield. Star Dick Quaney to sing
Happy Holiday, Happy Holiday, while the merry bells keep ringing, may your every wish come true. Happy Holiday, Happy Holiday. May the calendar keep bringing happy holidays to you. Don't let it bother you when things go wrong. If you're glum, just hum, and some good luck will come along. Don't let it bother you if now and then you may stumble, never grumble, count from 1 to 10. Frown with a smile upside down, so turn that frown upside down and smile and see. Don't let it bother you if skies are gray. Learn to grin, take it on the chin, everything will be okay. Happy holiday, happy holiday. May the calendar keep bringing happy holiday to you.
Happy New Year. Dick, take a bow. Wonderful. Ah, you're wonderful. As usual. Ah, Dick, that voice. You know, when I was young, I had a beautiful voice, too. I used to sing in the sheet music department at Macy's until they caught me singing in the wrong register. In the wrong register. Happy New Year. I'm kidding. Gosh, Mr. Gallup, you know, I can't wait until tomorrow night. I'm really going to hit the high spots. Well,
Burl, an intelligent man stays home New Year's Eve.
I know. I stayed home last year and never again. Did I ever tell you what happened to me last New Year's Eve?
No.
Would you like to hear about it?
No.
Gee, you're getting so nosy lately. Anyway, here's what happened. You want to know what happened?
I'd love to know what happened.
What? You will do the straight lines on the show. Well, here's what happened. I could say that for another hour and we'd have no program. My wife and I were invited to a New Year's party at our neighbors, the Harrisons. But I decided, Mr. Gallup, just for once, I was going to stay home and just spend a nice, quiet New Year's Eve. And my wife was all dressed up, and I'll never forget it.
Milton, it's the most ridiculous thing I ever heard, staying home New Year's Eve. You're getting as dead as those jokes you tell.
Now, darling, you just run along next door to the Harrisons and try to have a good time without me.
Try? You're kidding.
I'll call you at midnight and wish you a happy new year. Good night, darling.
Good night, Speedy.
Nice cozy evening in my easy chair at home. Now I can finally read that book Mr. Gallup gave me for Christmas. Oh, here it is. The Rise and Fall of the Roman Empire. Nice of him to remember I like baseball. It's a pretty big book. I bet before I even get to the middle of it, I guess who did it. Let's see. Here's the first page. Preface. Gallup said it was a hard book to read. Oh, no. No, that knock. That's Sam Harrison and his wife, Martha. Come in.
Happy New Year, Mildy! And that goes for Martha, too, doesn't it, Martha?
Yes.
Hello, Sam. Hello, Martha. Oh, you brought the little daughter of yours over, Susie.
Yes, your wife suggested since you're staying home, we bring her over here.
Sam, please, I'm tired.
Milty, your New Year's Eve party's no place for a little 5-year-old girl. You know the kind of stories I tell once I get going. Hey, Martha.
Yes.
Okay, come in, Susie.
Now, be a good little girl, Susie, and don't bother your Uncle Milty. Good night, Milty.
Well, well, well. Here we are, little Susie. Uncle Milty and little Susie are going to spend a nice, quiet New Year's Eve together, aren't we?
Yeah.
Just as gabby as her old lady. Susie, while Uncle Milty reads, wouldn't you like to go into the kitchen and play house?
Yeah.
Good, good. Now, go right ahead. Nice kid. Now for the book. Introduction. Gee, it's getting easier. Oh, brother. Susie?
Yeah?
Did you knock over the kitchen cabinet?
Yeah.
Look, Susie, you better stay here with me. I have it. Would you like to play some gin rummy with Uncle Milty? Penny a point?
Yeah.
All right, here are the cards. You deal. Wait, a card fell under the table. You get it, Susie. That's it. Penny a point. I'll send her home in a barrel. Oh, there you are, Susie. Deal the cards. Ah, this is nice. Let's have some music. I'll get up and turn on the radio. Ow, ow! I'm falling! Look out! Ow, ooh, ooh, my back. Get the lampshade off my head. There. Susie?
Yeah?
While you were under the table, did you tie Uncle Milty's shoelaces together?
Yeah.
Susie, you wouldn't want Uncle Milty to break his leg, would you?
Yeah.
Now listen, kid. Now listen. No more horsing around. You pick up those cards and play. There. Let's see what I got. Oh, oh, what a hand. Get this. I knock with two. Oh, you only have one, haven't you?
Yeah.
Susie?
Yeah?
Did you deal off the bottom?
Yeah.
I'll deal this time. Come in.
Excuse me, mister. I got stuck in the snow outside. Can I use your phone?
Oh, all right. There it is. It's in the hall.
Thanks. Hello, operator? Get me Denver, Colorado.
Wait a minute. You're calling Denver?
It's my brother's car. I want to tell him what happened.
Do me a favor. Write to him. I'll pay for the stamp. Look. Just call for a tow car.
Okay. Operator, get me Schmidt's garage.
Now, maybe we can play another hand. Pick up your cards, Susie. I said pick up your cards. Why are you laying them down? Oh. Gin?
Yeah.
I give up. Now go play by yourself. Bang your head against a wall or something.
Say, mister, mind if I wait in here till the tow car comes?
Okay.
Gee, you're swell. I'll call the gang.
The gang?
They're in the car. Hey, gang, come on in.
Hey, wait a minute. Don't call. Now, wait a minute, please. No drinking. There's a child in the house. Please, what are you doing?
Blocking the street.
Now look, mister, a tow car's coming any minute.
I don't care what's coming. Who's the owner? Ah, liquor.
Now wait a minute.
Come on in, gang.
No more, no more, please. Quiet. I gotta get out of here. I'm going out and move those cars myself. Where's the door? Gosh, the cars are stored for blocks. They'll be here till the 4th of July. Oof, it's freezing. I better go in.
The door's locked. Hey, open up, open up.
What do you want?
Let me in.
Sorry, the guy that lives here said no more. Beat it.
That doesn't. I'm crawling in through this window here and throwing them all out. Here's the window. Wait till I... Oh, hey, my neck!
Oh, no, you don't.
Oh, please, let go of my neck. Oh, it's you, officer. You see, officer, I live here.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
We've been waiting months to get you, second story, Solly.
But, officer, you don't understand. I live in this house. These people...
It's midnight. Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year, Sam. Oh, imagine Milton at home missing all this excitement. Well, that's Milton. He said he'd phone.
Hello, dear.
Milton, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Is it nice and quiet there, Milton?
Wonderful, darling. I'm reading that book. I should have it finished by the time I see you.
Finished? But it's such a big book.
I know, but I got 30 days to do it in.
30 days?
I'm in jail. Aren't we, Susie?
Yeah.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much. I'll be back in a jiffy. In the meantime...
Here's a wonderful suggestion if you're planning to go to a New Year's party tomorrow night. Take along a holiday carton of Philip Morris for your host. It's a thoughtful gift that's always welcome, always appreciated. For a gift of Philip Morris is a gift of the world's finest tobaccos, mellow and mild and superbly blended. Yes, a gift of perfect smoking pleasure. So make a note to take along a carton of Philip Morris to your New Year's party tomorrow night. Yes, say Happy New Year to your friends with Philip Morris. And remember, when you give Philip Morris, you give America's finest cigarette.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gallup. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Philip Morris and Johnny, may I wish you all a very, very, very happy New Year. And tomorrow night, if you want to make it a happier New Year, drive carefully and make sure most of the alcohol is in your radiator. Happy New Year, everyone.
If every smoker knew what Philip Morris smokers know, they'd all change to Philip Morris, America's finest cigarette. And now, goodbye, Johnny. See you next Tuesday, same time, same station. Listen in Sunday night when Johnny presents Philip Morris Night with Horace Hyde over this same network. Until then...
Hello, testing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That's it, 5. Pipe smokers, try Revelation pipe tobacco, a smooth blend of 5 tobaccos. Yes, relax, take 5, take Revelation, a fine pipe tobacco. The Dozen Barrel Show was written by Nat Hyten and Aaron Rubin, and this is Frank Gallup saying goodbye for Philip Morris.
This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
Hi, I'm singer Betty Johnson, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
Back with you once again, folks. Hope you enjoyed the Milton Berle Show. That was Salutes the New Year from Tuesday, December 30th, 1947, originally over NBC. We have two more New Year's-themed programs to bring you here on this edition of The Glowing Dial. We're going to start with those right after these all-important words. Hi, Big John here to tell you all about the Glowing Dial online store. The Glowing Dial online store is your one-stop shop for all things Glowing Dial. You're sure to be fashionable with a t-shirt or sweatshirt emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. And your favorite beverage will taste even better in an official Glowing Dial mug or stein. How about a Glowing Dial tote bag so you can carry around your OTR with style and grace? Or be the first on your block to own Volume 1 of the Glowing Dial Celebrity Interviews on audio CD. You can surf the internet with class with an official Glowing Dial mouse pad. And if that weren't enough, we'll be adding more items with new logo designs in the near future. Remember, every time you purchase an item from our online store, you're helping to support us here at the Glowing Dial. You know, you don't even have to leave your home and trudge into your overcrowded, noisy mall. You can just sit comfortably in front of your computer and do all your shopping online. All you have to do is to point your browser to glowingdial.com, click on the Glowing Dial online store link. Then, through the wonders of internet technology, you would be instantly whisked to our store's main page. There, you'll see all the items we have to offer. You're sure to find something to suit your fancy. And remember, our official Glowing Dial items make great gifts, too. And the ordering process is simple and safe using CafePress.com's secure server. Most orders are shipped within 2 business days. You can even check on the status of an existing order. So head on over to the Glowing Dial online store, the only place you can get official Glowing Dial merchandise. So what are you waiting for? Big John and Greg back with you once again, and we are ready to present an episode of Sherlock Holmes to you. This is called New Year's Eve off the coast of the Scilly Isles. And I don't mean silly. Yep. This is S-C-I-L-L-Y. It's from Sunday, December 28th, 1947, originally over Mutual. And this is starring John Stanley and Alfred Shirley as Holmes and Watson. Cy Harris is announcing, and the sponsor is Clipper Craft Clothes for Men. Now, Greg is standing by with some information on Sherlock Holmes, and this is a series that started so many different runs in the early 30s, all the way to, I think it's, they're over in the BBC, they're probably still doing it. But Greg's going to tell us a little bit more about that.
Indubitably, my dear John. The New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes aired from October 2nd, 1939 to July 7th, 1947. Originally, the show starred Basil Rathbone as Sherlock Holmes and Nigel Bruce as Dr. Watson. Together, they starred in 220 episodes, which aired weekly on Mondays from 8:30 to 9 o'clock. Bromoquinine sponsored some of the earliest programs on the NBC Blue Network. The show later moved to the Mutual Broadcasting System. Basil Rathbone's last episode as the famous detective was The Singular Affair of the Baconian Cipher. He was eager to separate himself from the cast type of Holmes, and even though the show's sponsor, Petri Wine, offered him generous pay to continue, he decided to move on. Once he did, the sponsor did as well, and Tom Conway took the starring roles, though Nigel Bruce got top billing and was always announced first. The new sponsor was Kreml Hair Tonic for Men, and the new series only lasted 39 episodes. Other sponsors over the years were George Washington Coffee, Household Finance, Bromoquinine, and Clipper Craft Clothes for Men. With Rathbone and Bruce, the show exhibited an interesting introduction. The sponsor's spokesman would show up weekly at Dr. Watson's house, then retired and living in California, and share a story about Sherlock Holmes and his adventures over a glass of Petri wine. This offered them the chance to sometimes bring in other characters to contribute to the story, and also gave Watson a chance to summarize or add additional tidbits at the end. Many other incarnations of Sherlock Holmes appeared on radio between 1930 all the way up to the present day, and were heard at different times on NBC, NBC Blue, Mutual, CBC in Canada, and the BBC in the United Kingdom. Among the other actors who played Sherlock Holmes over the years were William Gillette, Clive Brooke, Richard Gordon, Lewis Hector, John Stanley, George Shelton, Ben Wright, John Gielgud, and Norman Shelley. Dr. Watson over the years was played by Leigh Lovell, Harry West, Alfred Shirley, Ian Martin, Eric Snowden, Sir Ralph Richardson, and Carlton Hobbs. Sherlock Holmes also appeared in many books, films, and television series. The most popular films are the ones featuring Basil Rathbone and Nigel Bruce, whereas the most popular television series has to be the current BBC hit Sherlock, featuring Benedict Cumberbatch as Holmes. The most unusual, in my opinion, is the cartoon Sherlock Holmes in the 22nd Century.
Oh, I see. You added a little bit of your own there at the very end there. I don't believe that I had prepared that last animated comment. I didn't even know there was an animated Holmes.
It was actually pretty good. The premise was really out there, but the cartoon itself was actually quite good.
Have you seen the BBC one with Benedict Cumberbatch?
No, I have not, but it is on my list.
Those are pretty good. Yeah, I got to say.
And there's also Elementary, which is a U.S. TV show.
Oh, okay. There's also a type of school that I went to as well.
So. Elementary, my dear John.
Yes, I didn't have any teachers named Holmes or Watson, unfortunately, but I think my favorite pairing of them has got to be Rathbone and Bruce. Those are the first ones I've saw, you know, in the Universal films of the 30s and 40s. Mm-hmm. Well, 1939 was Hound of the Baskervilles, and then throughout the 40s they portrayed Holmes and Watson in a bunch of films for Universal. And I like those. That's just the best teaming for me, although a lot of purist fans may not care for that particular pairing. But, you know, amongst all the names we were mentioning, the people that played Holmes and
lots of them.
And Watson,
yeah.
One that I didn't even put in there was Andrew Sachs has played Sherlock Holmes for the BBC, I believe. And Andrew Sachs might be known to a lot of you as Manuel from Fawlty Towers, the Spanish waiter who spoke precious little English and drove Basil Fawlty just nuts. Played by John Cleese, of course. What a great show that was. 12 or 15 episodes, I think, is all it was.
Mm-hmm.
It should have gone more, because those things were just high octane and great fun. Anyway, it's time to get this episode to you, folks, so that means manipulating those tuning dials. I can't say manipulating too well today. I don't know
manipulating.
Why. Manipulating. I'll manipulate her. All right. No, maybe not. We'll manipulate you now. I'm talking to the McGee machine, of course, not you, Greg.
Oh, thank goodness.
Thank you, yes, yes. Family show. Folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember, Sherlock Holmes, this is New Year's Eve off the coast of the Scilly Isles from Sunday, December 28th, 1947, originally over Mutual.
Makers of Clipper Craft Clothes for Men and 924 leading retail stores from coast to coast present the world's most famous detective, Sherlock Holmes. Our stories are based upon the character of Sherlock Holmes created by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Sherlock Holmes is portrayed by John Stanley, Dr. Watson by Alfred Shirley, and the dramatizations are by Edith Meiser. Well, here we are once again on the threshold of Dr. Watson's study. We find Mr. Holmes' genial biographer strutting up and down in front of his fireplace. Evening, Doctor. You look fit. The Christmas festivities don't seem to have got you down.
I am fit, Mr. Harris, very fit. Better than that, I'm rather well fitted. Great Scott, man, where are your eyes?
Why, Dr. Watson, don't tell me Santa Claus brought you a Clippercraft suit.
Well, why not? Just because I'm a wee bit venerable doesn't mean I'm antique. I still enjoy making a good impression, don't you know?
Well, in that suit, it'll be the girls that go when you walk down the street, Doctor.
Oh, Mr. Harris.
Seriously now, Doctor, suppose you tell us what tonight's story is to be about.
Well, tonight I thought I'd relate how Holmes and I spent New Year's Eve off the Scilly Isles.
The Scilly Isles? That sounds appropriate, Doctor.
The name of these particular islands is spelled S-C-I-L-L-Y. They are located roughly 100 miles southwest of Land's End, Mr. Harris.
Oh, what in the world were you doing there on New Year's Eve?
Trying to prevent a great maritime catastrophe. You remember what happened to the Titanic? You know what happened to the Lusitania? Well, the lives of those on the ocean liner Gigantic were in even greater danger when Holmes and I went over the side on New Year's Eve in the year 1912. Oh, but good heavens. There I go getting ahead of myself again. Suppose I fix us a Tom and Jerry while you tell our listeners how to start the year right in a Clippercroft's clothes.
Fair enough, Dr. Watson. Millions of men, like you, will start the new year in a smart new Clippercroft suit and overcoat. Yes, today more men than ever before wear Clippercroft clothes, for we've sold more Clippercroft clothes than ever before in our entire history. There's a reason, of course. The wise old American public, with its eye for value, has pronounced Clippercroft the most remarkable clothing buys they've ever seen. The reason for these amazing values is the sensational Clippercroft plan, concentrating the buying power of 924 of the nation's leading stores from coast to coast. It accounts for tremendous savings in manufacturing and distribution costs. That's why truly fine Clippercroft suits are only $40 and $45. Why, Clippercroft top coats and overcoats are only $40, and sport jackets only $26.50. Clippercroft values are downright amazing. Compare them with clothes selling for many dollars more. And now, Dr. Watson, to return to the New Year's Eve you and Sherlock Holmes celebrated on the good ship Gigantic.
Yes. Here's your Tom and Jerry, Mr. Harris.
Thank you, Doctor.
Careful, don't burn yourself. Yes, it was probably the most hectic New Year's Eve I've ever experienced. Nothing is as terrifying to a seafaring man as the thought of fire aboard ship. The panic, the isolation. Oh, but that's neither here nor there. Yes, let me see. It was the last day of the year, 1912. Its inception was sufficiently placid, I must say. A light snow was falling as Holmes and I seated ourselves on either side of a well-filled breakfast table. The flames of our sea coal fire reflected themselves cheerfully in the generous coffee pot. The whole house was filled with the pleasant aroma of the stuffing Mrs. Hudson was preparing for our New Year's goose. Suddenly there came a frantic jangle at the front door bell.
No, definitely no.
No what, Holmes?
Whoever it is that's pulling our front doorbell out by the roots and whatever his problem is, I'm definitely not interested. Yes, Watson, being the world's greatest consulting detective has its disadvantages. People always manage to get into difficulties at the most inopportune moments.
Yes, you should try being a doctor, Holmes. No female since Eve has ever decided to become a mother at a convenient time.
Oh, come in, confound it.
Mr. Holmes? Mr. Sherlock Holmes?
Naturally. Whatever your problem is, I warn you, it'll have to wait till after the holidays.
But it can't wait, Mr. Holmes. Close to 2,000 lives are at stake. I pray to heaven you'll be able to reach them before it's too late.
Reach whom? Where? And what is this disaster you anticipate with such trepidation?
The steamship Gigantic, Mr. Holmes. She should be somewhere off the Scilly Isles by midnight. We've been reliably informed that an attempt will be made to set fire to her at that time. If successful, it'll be the greatest disaster in all maritime history.
Yes, in that case, I suppose I shall have to forego the little celebration I'd planned for this evening.
Have to? Well, really, Holmes, you are a cold-blooded fish.
Oh, I'm sorry, I don't believe you've met my colleague, Dr. Watson. Mr. Pembroke.
Reginald Pembroke.
How do you do, sir?
I'm chairman of the board of Floyd's, the famous insurance company.
Oh, then your desire to prevent this disaster isn't entirely humanitarian.
Not entirely, but neither is it altogether mercenary. There's more at stake than the lives of the passengers on board the Gigantic. If she goes down, the financial stability of the British Empire goes with her.
Interesting, eh, Watson? Continue, Mr. Pembroke.
You may not be aware, Mr. Holmes, that during this past year, there have been a terrifying number of marine catastrophes.
Holmes knows everything, Mr. Pembroke.
I'm quite cognizant of the fact that quite a few of the newest and fastest British liners have been destroyed at sea by fire, storm, and accident.
Ah, they weren't accidents, Mr. Holmes, I assure you.
Quite. The Egyptian Star was destroyed by fire in the Persian Gulf. 800 lives lost. The Lord Nelson disappeared in a typhoon in the Indian Ocean. No survivors. The Southern Cross exploded and sank off the coast of Brazil. 1,200 casualties. The Wellington, the Lady Jane Grey, and the El Dorado all caught fire in different parts of the Pacific. Total deaths, over 2,000. But the greatest disaster was last April, when the Titanic ran into an iceberg with a loss of over 1,500 souls.
The public's becoming panicky about traveling on British ships. The ships of other nationalities are taking all our trade. Three banks and nearly 10 investment concerns with large marine interests have gone to the wall. Even Floyd's is not too secure. But that is not the most serious aspect of the situation.
Really?
Good Lord, don't tell me there's worse to come.
Much worse, Dr. Watson. Those ships disappeared in many parts of the world. They were sunk by diverse methods. One factor, however, was the same in each disaster.
And that was?
The cargo carried by each ship was gold. English gold.
Oh.
If it ever became known how much British bullion lies at the bottom of the seven seas, British credit would be badly crippled. As a matter of fact, the Bank of England has been forced to import a large shipment of gold from Canada.
And it's on the Gigantic. Good Lord, no wonder you're upset.
The whole economic structure of the British Empire is at stake, Mr. Holmes. Nothing must happen to the Gigantic.
What makes you think anything will?
A cable was sent shortly after the Gigantic left Queenstown. She makes a stop in Ireland on her eastbound voyage, you know. She sails shortly before dawn this morning. The gangplanks have been drawn in, the last line have been cast off, and the great propellers have begun to churn. Suddenly the dockmaster noticed someone sliding down the ship's side on a rope.
Hi, look up there, sir. Some fool's climbed over the side. He's coming down on a rope.
Go back, you fool. Go back. He'll be killed.
He'll never make the dock. He'll fall in the water and be swept under the ship.
No, no. He's pushing the rope away from the ship with his feet. He's swinging out. He's going to jump.
He made it.
Someone up on the bridge has seen him. He's calling to him.
The chap's picked himself up. He's shouting back.
Happy New Year to you up there. Happy New Year. In hell?
Good Lord, I know the man, sir. It's Smoky Joe, the firebug. If the Gigantic don't catch fire between here and Southampton, I'm a Dutchman.
Smoky Joe. Seems to me we've heard of him before, eh, Watson? Not merely as an expert arsonist, but a dangerous pyromaniac as well. They caught him, I hope, Mr. Pembroke.
No, no, Mr. Holmes. Unfortunately, he was too quick for them. He crawled down a ladder and disappeared among the pilings under the docks.
So, the Gigantic is headed for Southampton with a nice bit of Joe's handiwork aboard.
You think it's a firebomb, eh, Holmes?
Not necessarily, Watson. There are many ingenious ways of starting a fire, you know. Whoever hired Joe would prefer to have it happen well out to sea, I imagine.
Our thought exactly, Mr. Holmes. We've wireless Captain Brooks to make a search, of course, but on a ship the size of the Gigantic, it's like looking for a needle in a haystack. You are our one hope, Mr. Holmes. If only you couldn't get on board in time.
And how do you suggest I go about that little assignment?
The chairman of the Great Western Railway has placed the Royal Train at your disposal. All other traffic will be cleared off the tracks. Now, you should reach Land's End shortly after lunch. My yacht, the Albatross, will be waiting for you in the harbor at St. Ives. It's a very speedy little craft, and with any luck, you should sight the Gigantic around 11 o'clock tonight.
Yes, 11 o'clock. What was it Smoky Joe called out? Happy New Year in hell. It won't be New Year till midnight. If we reach the Gigantic by 11, we may just possibly be in time. Six bells. It's 11 o'clock. Confound this fog. We've had to reduce our speed to half.
Oh, we'll never catch up to the Gigantic now, Holmes.
Nonsense. She's had to slow down, too. I only hope we don't miss her entirely in this fog.
I don't really care.
You don't sound very fit, Watson. What's up?
Do you have to use that unfortunate expression?
And tell me you're feeling squeamish.
It's this confounded roll. I can stand a good brisk sea, but this bobbing about in a teacup.
Pity I didn't bring the Mothersill's seasick pills.
Oh, Mothersill's bar. There's only one remedy for this sort of thing.
What's that?
Staying on shore. Jolly way to spend New Year's Eve, this is. Who do you suppose is responsible for these confounded sinkings, anyway?
Mr. Pembroke seems to feel it's a foreign plot. The Middle East European shipping industries benefit the most, of course.
Holmes, did you hear that?
By Jove, yes.
Sounds like an ocean liner, right enough.
Yes, we're signaling her.
It's Scott. There she is, the Gigantic looming out of the fog. Looks like a mountain coming at us.
Yes, Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson coming aboard. Let down a ladder.
Ladder coming over. Look out below.
Here's the ladder, Watson. Think you can manage it?
I'd climb up the Eiffel Tower on a clothesline if it would get me off this bouncing coffer shell.
Quite an impressive array of instruments you have up here on the bridge, Captain Brooks.
Yes, Mr. Holmes. On the Gigantic, we have the latest of everything. And none of it's any real use in case of fire. I'd sooner face a typhoon or a shipwreck, or a mutiny even, Dodd rat it, than a fire on board ship.
But surely a ship this size should be fairly fireproof.
That's what you might think, Dr. Watson. But there are three factors that make a fire on a luxury liner dangerous. First, there's all the confounded ornamental woodwork that's used in a passenger construction. Second, there's the fact that once a fire gets a firm hold, it's fed by drafts that rush through the ventilating system. And third, there is the element of panic. Nothing makes people behave more like wild beasts quicker than the cry of fire.
In case of fire, you have, of course, an alarm system.
Oh, we have the old-fashioned system of bells and also something rather recent. The Gigantic is one of the first ships to install it. You see that glass case over there, gentlemen?
The one with a lot of tubes entering from below. Looks rather like a giant honeycomb, eh, Holmes?
Each of those tubes leads to a separate compartment of the ship. The instant a fire breaks out anywhere, smoke is immediately drawn up into the glass case. I've stationed a sailor to watch that case. Believe me, gentlemen, the first wisp of smoke, we shall know it.
Yes, undoubtedly very helpful, Captain Brooks, in the case of an ordinary conflagration. But I assure you, a fire set by Smoky Joe is not ordinary. He's a master arsonist. 10 seconds after one of his fires breaks out, you're dealing with a raging inferno.
Oh, confound it, they tell me the man deserted the ship at Queenstown. That is this morning. Well, that's more than 18 hours ago. If he'd set fire, it seems to me that we'd be in flames by this time.
Not necessarily. There are many methods by which a fire can be made to break out long after the pyromaniac has left the scene of his crime. You say you found no time bombs, no inflammable acids.
No, Mr. Holmes. Ever since I received word that we were in danger, I've had my men searching high and low. They found nothing, absolutely nothing. It's been a systematic search, I promise you.
Yes, but you've drawn a blank. That's what comes of using system instead of brains and initiative.
Oh? And how do you propose to locate whatever it is we can't find?
By using a little logic. I shall credit Smoky Joe with having the intelligence to place his fire-starting device in the place where it'll do the most damage. The man's no amateur, Captain. He knows his business. Then I shall investigate that place and remove his handiwork.
Holmes, you're bragging again.
Not at all, my dear Watson. I think I may promise I shall have discovered the menace inside of half an hour. I only hope Joe's little device doesn't do its nasty job before then.
Half an hour. It's now 11:30 exactly. Do you think you can solve this problem by midnight?
Yes, Captain. With any luck, I think I can promise you a placid and uneventful new year.
Captain Brooks.
Yes, Mr. Brown. What seems to be the trouble?
The wireless engineer, sir, wishes to report that something's wrong with his apparatus. Both the sending and receiving equipment have suddenly gone out of commission.
I don't like that. What does he think is
Pardon
the matter?
Pardon me, Captain. Can you come here a minute?
Excuse me a moment, gentlemen. The wheelsman is calling me. What's the trouble, Jerry?
It's the compass, sir. It's spinning like a top. I can't figure out what's got into it. Never seen the like except once in some magnetic storm.
Great Scott, this is incredible. Now what?
It's the engine room calling, Captain.
I'll take it. Hello? Yes, Captain Brooks speaking. The blazes, you say? Well, do the best you can.
Seems to be the difficulty, Captain.
The dynamos are slowing down. They can't figure out why.
Good Lord, sir. That's why the lights are getting dim.
Blazes with the lights. Without dynamos, we've no forced draft for the furnaces. We'll never keep up enough steam pressure to drive the ship. In no time at all, we'll be drifting helplessly in the Atlantic, in the middle of the reefs that surround the Scilly Isles.
Jolly way to spend New Year's Eve, eh, Holmes?
It could be worse, you know.
How?
The ship could be on fire. That's the real menace, to which these other threats are but the prelude, I fancy.
For the love of heaven, what are we to do?
Keep calm and use whatever intelligence the Lord has endowed us with. Captain Brooks, I suggest you and as many officers as you can spare join the holiday celebration that's undoubtedly going on in order to keep discipline in case there's any disturbance.
Very good, Mr. Holmes. There's a New Year's dance going on in the large ballroom. It's on sea deck.
And meanwhile, if you can spare us someone to guide Watson and myself.
Oh, of course. And Mr. Brown here is our purser. He knows the ship as well as anyone aboard.
I'm sure he does. Very well, Mr. Brown. If you'll lead the way, I think Dr. Watson and I would like to go below.
And investigate the engines?
No, Mr. Brown, even lower than that. What we're looking for is apt to be rather close to the furnaces, I imagine.
These iron stairs that go round and round to make me dizzy. Maybe it's the heat down here.
Yes, we're getting close to the furnace room. If you listen, you can hear the men stoking.
Grim way to earn a living, eh, Holmes?
Stop a minute. Where does that lead, Mr. Brown? That small corridor with a heavy metal door at the far end.
That's the bullion room, sir, where the gold is kept.
Very interesting. Suppose we take a look, eh, Watson?
Yes, I've always wanted to see those gold bars you hear so much about.
I'm afraid that won't be possible, Dr. Watson.
Why not?
Well, as you can see, the door is locked and sealed. It was done by the port authorities before we left New York. That door won't be opened until the port authorities unseal it when we reach Southampton.
You mean that room in there wasn't opened when the captain ordered the ship searched for incendiary material?
No, Mr. Holmes. But it's quite impossible for anyone to place a fire bomb or anything of the sort in there. As you can see, the seals are still intact.
Quite. These seals are intact. But are they the ones put on in New York? I doubt it. Let's have a look. Yes, interesting. Very interesting. These are not the original seals.
Oh, how can you tell, Holmes? They look intact to me.
Exactly, they are intact. But here in the crack of the door sill are bits of broken seals. But these seals are not even chipped.
By Jove, yes, of course. The original seals were hacked off and then replaced after someone had finished picking the lock and robbing the room inside.
I doubt if robbery was the motive, Watson.
Well, for what other reason would anyone want to break into a room full of gold bullion?
It all depends. What lies directly below that room, Mr. Brown?
Let me see. Well, nothing of any great importance, Mr. Holmes. Just the coal piles.
The coal piles? Good Lord. I think we shall have to break the seals again, Mr. Brown. Here, Watson, help me.
But the door is locked, Mr. Holmes. Even after the seals have been removed, we shall have to get the key from the captain.
No time for that. Hand me my burglar tools, Watson.
All right, very well.
What? Good heavens, you mean you could actually pick a lock with those things?
If Holmes ever turned thief, Mr. Brown, even the Bank of England wouldn't be safe.
Yes, that should do the trick. Now, if you'll help me draw the bars, Watson.
Yes, with pleasure. Well, there you are, Holmes.
Now, let's see.
Say, it's black in there, isn't it?
Is there a light inside, Mr. Brown?
No, Mr. Holmes, I'm afraid not.
Then we shall have to prop the door open. The light from the corridor will have to do for our investigations. Come on, Watson.
Holmes, that smell. Phew. Strong and acrid. Like sulfur, only with more bite.
Seems to be coming from this large tin. Suppose I light a match...
Oh, Curtis Village, stop!
Don't be alarmed. I know better than to light a match around a tin which is leaking sulfuric acid. I only wanted to know how much you knew about Smoky Joe's incendiary device, Mr. Ludwig Brown, spelled B-R-A-U-N, if I'm not mistaken.
So you recognize me?
Yes, that dueling scar over your left eye. It's rather a giveaway, don't you know?
So you have found how we are going to set fire to the ship by having the acid drip through a hole in the floor under the coal beneath. The first shovelful of that acid-soaked coal that goes in the furnace, and the hold of a ship will be a blazing inferno. Nothing could put out that fire.
Don't you mean that's how you were going to start the fire?
My dear Mr. Holmes, you do not think we will let a small obstacle like the famous Sherlock Holmes stand in our way?
Now listen to me.
Don't raise your fist to me or I'll let you have it.
Never argue with a Luger pistol, Watson.
Well, that's the first sensible remark you've made, Mr. Holmes. I'm sorry to leave, but the stokers should reach the sulfuric acid impregnated coal in about 10 minutes, I believe. So I must be going. This room will be a roaring oven once it starts. You'll be rather badly overdone, gentlemen. Goodbye, then. So sorry I cannot say auf Wiedersehen.
The door. He's bolted it. Even you can't open it now, Holmes.
Shut up, Watson, and help me look for the opening.
What opening, for heaven's sake?
The opening that leads to the tube that ends in the captain's new fire-detecting machine. It should be somewhere near the ceiling.
But, Holmes, I can't see a thing in this black hole of Calcutta.
You can feel, can't you?
Not a thing, Holmes. The wall on this side of the room, it's as smooth as an egg.
Confound it, if we could see for half a minute, it would... Hello, I've got something.
Yes?
Yes, a small grating here in the upper corner. This must be it. Now, if we can make a smudge of some sort. Watson, bring me a piece of paper.
Paper? Where would I find a piece of paper?
Then bring me anything I can burn. A bit of cloth, a piece of... Yes, by Jove, rope. Bring me a piece of the rope that's tied around one of the boxes that contain the bullion.
Very well, if I can find a box that...
Oof! Now what?
I found it. Confound it. The knots are tied so tight I can't...
Blazes with knots. Cut the rope, Watson. Use your pocket knife.
Oh, very well. There you are, Holmes. It's a short length, I'm afraid.
I only want enough for a smudge. Nothing like a bit of hempen rope to...
Holmes, for heaven's sake, you're not going to set a match to that thing in here. There'll be an explosion.
Have to take the chance, Watson. With any luck, the sulfuric acid fumes won't be too concentrated up here near the ceiling. Well, here goes. One. Two. Now, if we can persuade the rope to smolder. Yes, there she goes.
Certainly makes plenty of smoke, eh, Holmes?
Important thing, it's being drawn up through the grating.
How long before they come to investigate, do you suppose?
It all depends on the mental acumen of the sailor who's watching that fire-detecting machine.
Well, let's hope he's brighter than he looks. It may be my imagination, but it seems to me I can feel the metal flooring under my feet beginning to get hot.
Most things in 1948 will cost you a great deal more than you've paid in other years. That's why it's sensational news to know that you can get Clippercraft suits in 1948 for only $40 and $45. Clippercraft top coats and overcoats for only $40, and sport jackets for only $26.50. And isn't it as good a time as any to decide to get the most for your money? You've every right to expect long wear, correct styling, good taste, comfort, and perfect fit. And you get all these to an astounding degree in Clippercraft clothes. And you get them at incredibly modest prices. It's, of course, American production genius applied to the making of fine clothes that does the trick. It's the unique Clippercraft plan, concentrating the buying power of 924 of the nation's leading independent stores from coast to coast. You get the benefit of this plan at your own locally owned store, the store you can trust. Selling expensive clothes at inexpensive low prices at the nation's finest independent stores is the great big idea behind the Clippercraft plan. That's why men who know insist on Clippercraft clothes. So be sure to visit the Clippercraft store in your city.
These leading stores in the metropolitan area are proud to add their names to Clippercraft in your suit, top coat, and overcoat. In Manhattan, Saks 34th, Broadway at 34th, John Wanamaker Men's Stores, Broadway at 8th and 67 Liberty Street. In Brooklyn, Abraham and Strauss. In Newark, New Jersey, Boulevard Men's Shop, Kresge Newark. And in Jamaica, the B&B Clothes Shop, 16408 Jamaica Avenue.
Now let's rejoin Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson, locked in the smoke-filled bullion room of the Gigantic.
How long does it take for them to get us out of here? That smoke's suffocating.
Calm yourself, Watson. It can't be more than 3 minutes since we lit this smudge. Yes, I can hear someone running down the iron staircase.
I can't hear a blasted thing. How do you...
Hello! Hello in there!
Get us out!
We're in here!
Open the door! What a relief.
How in thunder did you two get locked in here? What's all the smoke?
No time for explanations, Captain. Stop them stoking the furnaces. Flood the coal piles with water. They've been soaked with sulfuric acid.
Good Lord.
Lenjar, Gates, stop the firing. Stop the pumps in the engine room.
Well, that's that, Holmes. What do you suppose has become of that dastardly purser?
We'll let Captain Brooks take care of him, Watson. Unless I'm very much mistaken, Mr. Brown is going to wish he'd never gone to sea. Well, come along. Let's go upstairs and join the festivities. I think we rate a bottle of champagne.
Well, to blazes with the champagne, I need a double brandy. Eight bells. Let's see, that'd be...
Midnight, Watson. Happy New Year, old fellow.
Happy New Year, Holmes, and many of them. But, don't you think you could manage to have them not quite so hair-raising?
And have you getting fat and lethargic? You know, that would be unhealthy, not to say boring.
Oh, so now it's for my sake we indulge in all these horrendous escapades, eh? Fine bit of logic, that is.
Elementary, my dear Watson. Elementary. But here's the ballroom. Suppose we join the party.
Fine, my dear.
Well,
Well, Dr. Watson, that was an exciting way to spend New Year's Eve.
It was a bit too exciting, Mr. Harris, if you ask me.
Doctor, did they catch the purser?
Oh, they did indeed. Mr. Brown and five of his accomplices were thrown in the brig. That was the end of the disasters in the British Maritime Service.
When did Holmes first suspect the purser was the villain of the piece?
When he came onto the bridge and threw his overcoat on a chair near to the compass, whereupon the compass went berserk. Holmes immediately suspected the coat contained a powerful magnet of some sort.
And was he right, Doctor?
My dear Mr. Harris, was Sherlock Holmes ever wrong? But come, fill your mug and let us wish our radio friends a prosperous, happy, and peaceful New Year.
Indeed we do, Doctor. And now, Dr. Watson, would you like to give us a hint about next week's story?
Next week, I think I'll tell you how Holmes and I trapped a famous jewel thief right in our own rooms in Baker Street by the use of what was then a fabulous new invention, the gramophone.
The makers of Clippercraft clothes and 924 leading stores from coast to coast have brought you another in the new series of broadcasts featuring the world's most famous detective, Sherlock Holmes. Sherlock Holmes is produced and directed by Basil Ockren, with special music by Albert Berman. If you don't know your Clippercraft dealer, write Clippercraft, 200 Fifth Avenue, New York City. Be sure to listen next week to Sherlock Holmes in The Mazarin Stone. If you'd like to attend the Sherlock Holmes broadcasts in New York, see your local Clippercraft dealer, and he'll tell you how to obtain your tickets. Wishing you a happy and prosperous new year from all of us at Clippercraft. This is the world's largest network serving more than 450 radio stations and mutual broadcasting systems.
Good ladles, evening and gentlemen. This is Jay Ronburn inviting you to hear the Gliling Dole. I mean the Dueling Glile. Well, you know. It's the best in old-raid timey-o with Big Ston and Jeeve. Don't Dutch that tile.
And we're back with you once again, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Sherlock Holmes. That was New Year's Eve off the coast of the Scilly Isles. Not silly, but S-C-I-L-L-Y. From Sunday, December 28th, 1947, originally over Mutual. We have one more program to bring you here in the New Year's theme episode here on the Glowing Dial. We're going to get to that right after this message. Hi, Big John here to tell you how you can help support the Glowing Dial. You know, it takes a lot of time and effort to maintain the Glowing Dial page and produce new episodes of the show. It also takes something we usually don't have enough of, money. The Glowing Dial page and show are nonprofit entities, and all costs incurred come out of our pockets, and we could use a little help from you, our listeners. There are several ways you can help support the Glowing Dial, and all of these methods can be accessed on our main page at www.glowingdial.com. One way to support us is to check on the PayPal donation box icon on our main page and make a donation. It can be as little or as much as you can afford. Every little bit helps. Another way is to purchase items from the Glowing Dial online store through CafePress.com. There you will find an ever-increasing variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. You can also shop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Every time you order something from our bookstore, you are helping to support the Glowing Dial. If you're a fan of Dick Organ's radio work, then why not order the complete set of Chicken Man episodes on CD? Just scroll down our main page until you see those silly dancing chickens. Purchase of this set also helps to support us here at the Glowing Dial. So there you have it, folks. Four ways that you can help support us and ensure the continuation of the Glowing Dial page and show. We thank you in advance. We're back with you once again, folks. We have now an episode of Amos and Andy called The Mysterious New Year's Card from Sunday, December 26, 1948, originally over CBS. And this is starring Freeman Gosden and Charles Carell with Ernestine Wade, Lou Lubin, Eddie Green, and the Jubilaires, and Jeff Alexander's Orchestra and Chorus. The sponsor is Rinso. And over there, Greg is getting all ready to give us some more information on Amos and Andy. So let's hear it, Greg.
I got a dirty little secret about Amos and Andy.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes.
What is that?
Well, did you know that Amos and Andy were not really black?
Yes, I did.
Oh. Well, they may not. But anyway,
I think that's widely known, which is part of the controversy of the show over the years.
Oh, yeah. But yeah, it was a couple of white guys. They were creators Freeman Gosden and Charles Correll. And they had already, they were familiar with minstrel traditions, so that helped them out quite a bit. They had met in Durham, North Carolina in 1920. And they both had scattered experience in radio. But it wasn't until 1925 that the two appeared on Chicago's WQJ. Now, their appearances there soon led to a regular schedule on another Chicago radio station, WEBH. And the funny thing about working there is that they weren't paid in money. They were paid with food. They'd get a free meal out of the deal.
They sang for their supper.
They sang, they played, and they made you laugh for their dinner. The pairs, their hopes were that the radio experience would lead to stage work. And they were able to sell some of their works to a local band leader, Paul Ash, which brought them enough name recognition to be offered jobs at the Chicago Tribune station, WGN. Sound familiar? In 1925. The offer was steady and lucrative enough to allow them to now become full-time broadcasters. The Victor Talking Machine Company was also interested enough to offer them a recording contract. Now, the Tribune syndicated Sidney Smith's popular comic strip, The Gumps, which had successfully introduced the concept of daily continuity, and WGN's executive Bill McKenna thought that a serialized version would work on radio, so it would be, you know, radio play of The Gumps. He suggested that Gosden and Correll adapt The Gumps for radio. The idea seemed to involve more risk than either of them was willing to take. They weren't really adept at imitating female voices, which would have been necessary for The Gumps since The Gumps had mainly female characters. They were also conscious of having made names for themselves with their previous act. And so they weren't really up for, you know, that kind of thing, you know. But what they did is they proposed a series about a couple of black characters, but borrowing certain aspects of The Gumps. This new show would be called, not Amos and Andy, Sam and Henry. Which, now, this began back in January 12th, 1926, and it fascinated radio listeners throughout the Midwest. It became so popular that in 1927, the creators requested it to be distributed to other stations via phonograph records in what they called a chainless chain concept that would have been the first radio syndication. WGN rejected the proposal, and so, unfortunately, Gosden and Correll, they quit the show and the station. But episodes of Sam and Henry continued to be aired until July 14th, 1928. Now, contractually, the pair's characters belonged to WGN. So when they left the station, they performed in personal appearances, but they couldn't use the character names from the radio show. Another radio station, WMAQ, which was the Chicago Daily News Station, they hired Gosden and Correll and their former WGN announcer, Bill Hay, to create a series similar to Sam and Henry. They offered them higher salaries than WGN and the right to pursue the chainless chain syndication idea. The creators later said that they named the characters Amos and Andy after hearing a couple of elderly African-American gentlemen greet each other by those names in a Chicago elevator. Now, Amos and Andy, as a show, began on March 19th, 1928 on WMAQ, and prior to airing each program, they pre-recorded their show on 78 RPM disc at Marsh Laboratories, and early 1930s broadcasts of the show were done from the El Mirado Hotel in Palm Springs, California. For the program's entire run, As a nightly serial, Gosden and Carell portrayed all the male voices, performing over 170 distinct voice characterizations in the show's first decade. That's a lot of voices.
That's incredible. It is.
It really is. With the episodic drama and suspense heightened by cliffhanger endings, Amos and Andy reached an ever-expanding radio audience. It was the first radio program to be distributed by syndication in the United States, and by the end of the syndication run in August of 1929, at least 70 stations, besides WMAQ, carry the program by means of recordings. That is awesome.
And that's just the beginning of the history of Amos and Andy.
That's absolutely. The show went through several incarnations in the future years. Name changes, additions of characters. They had films, they moved to TV.
That's right.
They really had quite a longevity.
All right, thank you, Greg. Now we got that information out of the way. It's time to present this episode to you folks. So let's get to the McGee Machine and extract the episode from the ether of yesteryear.
I'm on it.
You're on it. I can hear that already. So folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember Amos and Andy, the mysterious New Year's card. From Sunday, December 26, 1948, originally over CBS.
This seems like Sunday.
Well, it is Sunday. You see, Andy, we is on the radio now every Sunday on CBS for Rinso.
That's right. Lever Brothers Company, the makers of new Rinso with Solium, brings you the show selected by you listeners as the best Amos and Andy program of 1948. Yes, sir. Rinso, the soap that contains Solium, the sunlight ingredient, brings you a full half hour of entertainment with Lou Lubin, Eddie Green, Ernestine Wade, the Jubilaires, Jeff Alexander's orchestra and chorus, and radio's all-time favorites, Amos and Andy. Kingfish, as head of the lodge, has asked a few of the members to come over to the lodge hall on a very important matter. They met at 8 o'clock in the evening, and now at 2:30 in the morning, they are still gathered around the conference table, diligently pursuing the business at hand.
Well, Brother Ender, what do you say?
I got a pair of aces.
What you got, Ender?
I've got three jacks.
Too bad, boys. I got a full house, 3 9s and 2 10s.
Wait a minute. Wait, hold the pot, fellas. Hold the pot. Hold it.
What you got, Jordan?
I got four of a kind. I got a spring. I got a first starting with it. I got a royal. I got a six card.
Wait a minute, though. That puts you out of the pot, Jordan. Well, it's my pot again, boys. Yeah, well, it's getting pretty late, too. I think we ought to call it quits. I've really been lucky tonight.
Yeah, I ain't won a pot all evening. I done lost 8 stacks.
Yeah, I lost 4 stacks myself.
Yes, and I'm out 6 stacks. You was the only winner, Kingfish. You cleaned everybody. How much did it amount to?
Well, now, let me see here. I win 18 stacks. 100 to a stack, 18, 11, 22, 47, 822. Boys, you owe me 8 cents.
Here,
there's
mine.
Yeah, put it in the middle of the table, boy. Here you are. Yeah, there
he is, Kingfish. Grand total's 8 cents. Well, it's late, fellas. I'm going to get on home.
Oh, wait a minute, Shorty. I'm going the same direction. I'll go with you.
Yes, and I'm going too, boys. Good night, Kingfish.
So long, Kingfish.
So long, boys.
So long, so long.
8 cents. 1, 2, 3, and a nickel. Wait a minute, sir. This here's a lead nickel. Now, how you like them cheats? Of all the low-down, sneaky, good-for-nothing tricks, a lead nickel. Serves them right that I was dealing off the bottom of the deck. Well, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. I certainly hope that my wife Sapphire is asleep.
be?
Hello there, honey. Just playing little innocent cards, honey. What you putting on the light for now? What you mad about?
I've been waiting up for you for 5 hours.
Yeah, well, now, what you been waiting up for, honey?
Because this come in the mail today.
Oh, I didn't get a chance to see the afternoon mail.
This was addressed to you, and I opened it by mistake. It's a New Year's card for you, signed from one who loves you, your sweetheart.
Well, now, honey, somebody playing, you see,
Joyce Stevens, I ain't so sure. You've been out late 3 or 4 nights in the past 2 weeks. How do I know you've been playing cards?
Yeah, well, there was nothing else for me to do, honey. I mean, you has been out in the evenings working on this welfare fund.
From one who loves you, your sweetheart. This female meant this to be sincere.
Yeah, but darling, I know I wouldn't even look at another woman, though, honey.
Oh, no? What about that party we went to the other night when that young girl walked in that form-fitting hand-knitted dress she claimed she made herself? You didn't take your eyes off of her all evening.
Honey, believe me, I was just trying to see what stitch she used. That's all I...
Now, listen, George, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. I ain't gonna get excited about this. But if this card is from a girl, I'll break your neck.
Well, I guarantee, honey, I'll find out who sent me that New Year's card.
You better find out who it's from. Good night.
Sweetheart, till we meet tomorrow.
Hey, come in, Ender.
Yeah, hi, Kingfish, hi.
Say, Ender, did you or anybody you know send me a New Year's card?
I know, Kingfish. What's the matter?
Oh, somebody played a dirty trick on me. I got a New Year's card in the mail, and it looked like the thing is from some gal. Oh, my wife, Sapphire, sees the thing and she's raving mad.
Well, who signed it?
No signature. It was anonymous.
Oh.
Tell the thing on the bottom from one who loves you, your sweetheart.
Yeah, well, a thing like that can cause serious reconcoctions at home, all right. What are you going to do about it?
Well, I heard of a married man over here that got a New Year's card from a strange gal, and his wife found it out, so I done sent Layton over to talk to him to see how he straightened it up with his wife, is he?
Oh, yeah. You gotta try everything, all right. What is all this mess you got here?
Well, I tell you what, I just got this out of the closet here. It's a box, and it's some old pictures and dresses in there, some of gals that I used to go with before I was married, you see.
Yeah.
Well, I want to see if one of them could have sent it to me.
Yeah, I can't tell. Maybe one of them old gals is still unsaturated with you.
Well, let's see here now. Here's a picture of a gal, but she's married and lives in California. Couldn't have been her.
Holy mackerel, look at this next picture. Did you know a dame as ugly as this one?
And that happens to be a picture of my wife, Sapphire.
Pretty. Yeah, she's pretty, yeah. I guess I had it upside down or something, can't you?
Look at here in this memory book, Andy.
Oh, yeah. There's a beautiful lock of hair. You sure was a romantic lover. What gal gave you this hair?
Gal, nothing. That's my hair.
Well, why would you put a lock of your hair in your memory book?
Well, if my hair ain't a memory, I don't know what's his now.
Oh, boy, look at this address book you got here.
Yeah.
You really know some gals. Look here, Gloria Armstrong. Tall girl, brown eyes, good dancer, but be careful. Can punch from sitting position.
Hey, I'm going to tell you something, boy. This is serious, you know what? Wait a minute. Come in. Did you get that information from me, Lightning?
Brother Kingfish, I went over to see that mad man that got a card from some gal, but I couldn't see him.
You don't do nothing right, Lightning. I sent you over to find out from the man how he straightened the mess up with his wife, and you come back here without seeing him.
Well, he didn't straighten it out. His wife did.
How?
She shot him.
Oh, me. Get out of here, Lightning.
Yes, sir. I'll whiz right on out.
Say, Kingfish, why is your eye so big?
Listen, Andy, on account of burglaries in the neighborhood lately, I gave my wife a .32 revolver for Christmas.
Sure enough.
So, Andy, if you see a strange gal crying at my funeral,
Tell her I'm sorry that I didn't get a chance to thank her for the card, will you?
Ezekiel say when he saw the chariot rolling?
He said, I want to go home to glory.
Why don't you swing down, sweet chariot stopping? Let me ride.
We
swing down, chariot stopping. Let me ride. Rock me, Lord, come and easy. I've gone home on the other side. Why don't you swing down, sweet chariot stopping? Let me ride. Swing down, chariot stopping. Let me ride. Rock me, Lord, come and easy.
Ezekiel was out in the middle of the field. He saw an angel working on the chariot wheel. Wasn't too particular about the chariot wheel. Just wanted to see how a chariot feels.
Why don't you swing, oh, sweet chariot, come and go to carry me home. Swing, oh, sweet chariot, come and go to carry me home.
Ezekiel went down and got on the board. The chariot went bumping, rolling down the road. Wasn't particular about bumping down the road. Just wanted to lay down his heavy load.
Why don't you swing down, sweet chariot stopping? Let me ride. Swing down, chariot stopping. Let me ride. Rock me, Lord, come and easy. I've got a home on the other side. On the other side, I've got my home.
I've got my home on the other side. If I could just make it in.
Go in the shortest barbershop here and see by any chance he knows who done sent me that card.
Yeah, let's do that.
Well, hello there, Shorty.
Hi, fellas. I'm glad you came in. I won't tell you what happened just outside the shop here. There were two cars coming from both of them scared. There was a fellow with a gun. He was a white. He started. The fire department had to put out a bit. Stop interrupting me, will you?
Listen, Shorty. Listen here, whatever happened, it ain't as important as what happened to the Kingfish. He wants to speak to you about a New Year's card that he got in the mail.
Yeah. Sure, speaking of New Year's cards, fellas, I just got one in the mail a few minutes ago. Here it is. I'll read it to you. Oh, it's really lovely.
What is the thing?
Oh, it's from Frank R. Thompson. You know that Undertaker and funeral director that's up the block?
Oh, yeah, I know that Undertaker. What did the card say?
Oh, it's beautiful. Listen, happy thoughts at the old year's end. For long I've been your trusted friend. And here's my thought for 49. Perhaps this year you will be mine.
Yeah, Shorty, that's a beautiful thought, all right.
Shorty, I've been trying to find out who sent me a New Year's card signed your sweetheart. Now, I don't know whether it was a joke or if it's from some gal that I ain't seen for a long time.
Hey, wait a minute, Kingfish. Does you remember a gal by the name of Helen Jackson?
Oh, yeah, I used to go with her, but before I married, met Sapphire, but she lived down in Georgia.
Yeah, I know, but about a month ago, she come to New York, you know. She's living in that apartment over the new drugstore. I mean, maybe she's sent it. I don't think she knows you as married.
Yeah, Helen Jackson, come to think of it, she used to call me sweetheart.
Mm.
I think I'll drop over and see her this evening. And see if she sent it. My wife will be out doing welfare work. I'll tell her that I go into a lodge meeting.
Yeah, that might be a good lead for the Kingfish, Shorty.
Yeah, well, boys, I'm going to close up the shop here. I'm tired.
Shorty, look here. You was one of the hardest working fellas I ever saw.
Oh, yeah. I'm working too hard. But tomorrow, I'm
gonna give you something in the shop here that'll save me a lot of time and work too. As a matter of fact, what I'm getting is gonna make it possible for me to shave two customers at the same time.
You could shave two customers at the same time?
Yeah, that's right.
Well, what in the world is you getting, Shorty?
Oh, I'm getting me one of them great big I'm getting a special 60 cycle. I'm getting one of them new electric. You push the button. You turn. You plug in the. That is when you get blah 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 blah. Another barber.
Oh yeah. Well, Shorty said that she lived in the apartment over the drugstore. Well, this must be Helen Jackson's place. She's the one that sent that card. I can clear this thing up right now. Women do the craziest thing.
Good evening.
Excuse me, but is you Helen Jackson?
That's right.
Does you remember George Stevens from down in Georgia?
George Stevens? Well, of course I can see the resemblance. You must be his father.
I was George Stevens, your old boyfriend.
Oh. Yes, George, so yeah. Won't you come in?
Yeah.
Take off your hat and coat.
Thank you very much.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't recognize you, George. I mean, Mr. Stevens. I hardly know what to call you. It's been years since we went together down in Georgia.
Oh, just call me the name you used to call me in them days.
All right. Well, how have you been, Egghead?
Clean forgot about that one. Helen, by any chance, did you send me a New Year's card?
No, I didn't send you a New Year's card. Why would I? Excuse me. Hello?
Miss Jackson?
Yes?
This is Mrs. Stevens, the chairman of the local welfare fund. One of our workers said you had a box of clothes to donate.
That's right.
Well, I happen to be in the drugstore right under your apartment. I thought I'd come up and get your contribution.
Well, that'll be fine. You can come right on up.
All right, I'll be up there in just a minute.
All right. I'll expect you. Goodbye, Mrs. Stevens.
You see, Helen, the reason I asked you about the card, did you just say, goodbye, Mrs. Stevens?
Yes, I did.
Yeah, well, I guess there's a lot of Stevens in New York, and telephone book must be loaded with them there. Now, as I was saying about the New Year's card...
She was down at the drugstore. She's on her way up here now. You see, she's the chairman of the local welfare committee, and I have some things for her.
Holy mackerel, that's the battle axe. I told her that I was in a lodge meeting tonight, or she'll never understand. Let me get out of here.
But Egghead...
Oh, wait a minute. Let me get down these steps. Oh, me, I left my overcoat in Helen's apartment. I just grabbing my overcoat. Holy smoke. I left my hat up there. Oh, here's my hat. Now let me get out of here.
Excuse me, is this the apartment?
Out of my way, madam. My wife's on the way up here.
George Stevens!
Sapphire.
George, what are you doing in this woman's apartment?
Well, I come up here. I went over.
What's going on? I'm going home right this second and start proceedings. I'm going to sue you for separate maintenance. Good night.
I tell you, Anna, this is the worst mess I've ever been in. After Sapphire caught me leaving the gal's apartment, she wouldn't even give me a chance to explain. She went right home to her mama.
Yeah, Kingfish, that's a mess, all right.
Yeah, but the worst thing is, she is suing me for separate maintenance. So far, I've been able to duck the process server that she got after me.
Yeah, a man looking for you with a summons, huh?
Oh, yeah, every time I see a Spanish man coming around here, I jump in that closet and lock the door from the inside.
Yeah, well, you know, maybe you could hide over at
the... Wait a minute, who's that coming down the hall there? Fred Gwindell, the newspaper man.
Oh, yeah. Come in, Gwindell.
Hello there, boys. Hello. Greetings and salutations.
I suppose you come over here to get the newspaper story about Sapphire suing the Kingfish for a separate mayonnaise.
No, boys. I tell you what, boys. I sue with the newspaper.
Yeah, well, that's good news to me. What happened?
Well, the editor wanted me to write a gossip column telling about scandal, about the married couples that I know in town that's having trouble, and I just wouldn't do dirty tricks like that to my friends, so I quit my job at the newspaper.
Well, now, that's what I call a gentleman and a true friend.
Sure is. What kind of job you got now?
As a process server. Here's your summons, Kingfish. See you in court.
You know, when I told a friend of my wife's that new rinseau with Solium puts sunshine in your wash, even if it's dried indoors, she said, "John Lake, that's the most wonderful thing I ever heard." You mean I can get a bright wash without getting my hands cold and raw hanging the wash on the line? Yes, I said, and what's more, rinseau in your wash, whether it's dried indoors or out, gets white clothes not just whiter, but whiter than new. And washable colors not just brighter, but brighter than the day you bought them. New rinseau, you see, contains the scientific sunlight ingredient, Solium. It's the result of wartime research by the famous laboratories of Lever Brothers Company. Rinseau with Solium gives your wash a new brilliance never known before new rinseau was developed. That wonderful rinseau brilliance must be seen to be appreciated. I think you'd better do your next wash with new rinseau. New rinseau is the only soap that contains Solium.
Like to warn the spectators, we will have no demonstration while Mrs. Stevens, the plaintiff, is on the stand. Will the attorney for the plaintiff please proceed?
Mrs. Stevens, do you think that you could finish telling the court what happened?
Well, Your Honor, I was collecting for the welfare fund. And when I reached the top of the steps by the door leading to Miss Jackson's apartment, the door opened and my husband come rushing out and almost knocked me down. She said, "Out of the way, madam. My wife is on her way up here." I seen him with my own eyes, and that's why I want separate maintenance.
That will be all. Does Mr. Stonewall, the attorney for the defendant, wish to cross-examine Mrs. Stevens?
No, ma'am. Don't you cross-examine her. She got the goods on her.
Stonewall, I is nervous.
Yeah, but I ain't worried, Kingfish. I got a perfect record in this court, and I'm out to win this case so I can break my losing streak.
If that Helen Jackson hadn't gone out of town, she would have made a good witness for us.
Order in the court. Continuing with the case of Stevens versus Stevens, attorney for the defense may now proceed.
Your Honor, I'd like to have my client, George Stevens, to take the stand.
Coming right up, yes.
Raise your right hand.
Yes.
You solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you?
Yes, sir, yes.
Now, Mr. Stevens, in her complaint, your wife stated that you were absent from your home on various occasions. She further implied that on these nights you was seeking feminine companionship with a beautiful girl. Was it, you rascal, you?
I was not.
Nice going, Bub. Now, Mr. Stevens, will you tell us in your own words what happened the night you lied to your wife about going to a large meeting and went to see your sweetheart, Helen Jackson, instead?
I just went to see this Helen Jackson to find out if she sent me a New Year's card and signed it your sweetheart. When she said she didn't, why, I rushed out of the apartment and I run into my wife just outside the apartment door.
No. There, Your Honor. That's my client's story, which shows exactly what his intentions were. Never for one moment what is his plan to let his wife catch him in his girlfriend's apartment.
Wait a minute, Stonewall.
Don't worry, client. We got him rolling, huh? Your Honor, I would like to review the facts at this point. The evidence against my client shows, first, he stayed out late nights. Second, he lied to his wife. Third, she caught him coming out of another woman's apartment. But now, let me list the overwhelming facts in favor of my client. Now, one, Mr. Stevens never... he wasn't the... Your Honor, can we have a recess till I can think of something better?
This is very irregular.
Your Honor, as attorney for the plaintiff in this case, could I have your permission to cross-examine the defendant for just a second before he leaves the stand?
Proceed with the cross-examination.
Well, Stonewall, what must I do?
Oh, don't worry, Kingfish. If you say anything out of line, I'll object right off the bat.
Yeah, well, get ready to object, because he's going to start on me here.
Now, Mr. Stevens, you admitted that you were a friend of Helen Jackson's. You admitted that you were alone in her apartment with her. Now, Mr. Stevens, just how friendly were you?
Stonewall, ain't you going to object to that question?
No, man, I kind of enjoy hearing the answer to that question.
Refuse to answer that question.
Yes, I'm glad to refuse. Thank you for giving me the chance. Yes.
Now, Stevens, if this whole thing was so innocent as you claim, why did you attempt to run out of the apartment when you knew your wife was coming?
I object, Your Honor.
Why do you object to your client answering that question?
Because it'll hurt his reputation, which ain't too good as it is. That is irrelevant, immaterial, and several other things. And not only that, it's very embarrassing to the defendant.
Well, I don't see anything so embarrassing about it.
Listen, Your Honor, how would you like to get caught coming out of a dame's apartment?
If you don't want your language in this court, you'll be cited for contempt.
Well, I'd like to apologize if I could.
Your Honor, could I interrupt this case?
Quiet in this courtroom, please. Now, what is it, Mrs. Stevens?
When I got off the witness stand, there was a long-distance telephone call waiting for me from Miss Helen Jackson in Georgia. She'd heard about the case, and she's then explained everything, and I would like to drop the charges against my husband.
Well, Mrs. Stevens, it's the policy of this court to preserve the family unit whenever possible. It gives me pleasure to grant your request. Case dismissed.
Oh, Sapphire, thank you, honey, thank you.
George, I'm sorry I accused you of being involved with Helen Jackson.
Oh, gee, I was glad you talked to that gal, and she straightened it out, honey. I was the happiest man in the world to be back with you.
Oh, I'm glad you're happy, George, and I'm glad the trial is over. But there'll always be a little something in my mind wondering who the female was that sent you that New Year's card.
Honey, look here, you has got to get that out of your mind. Well, Kingfish, me and Ruby is glad that you and Sapphire could come over for supper tonight and kind of celebrate you two getting back together again. Glad you could come too, Ender.
Yeah, when are we going to eat round here, Amos?
Sapphire's out in the kitchen now. Amos just said helping Ruby ought to be pretty quick, I guess. Well, Kingfish, I bet you is glad that trial is over, ain't you? I'll say I is, boy. But there's still a little cloud hanging over Sapphire's head about that New Year's card. And over mine, too.
Don't give us that stuff, you old wolf. Ha, ha, ha.
Ruby said if you boys is going to make so much noise, you better close the door to the kids' room. They're going to sleep.
Oh, thank you, Sapphire. Close the door, yeah. Da-da-dee-dee-dee. Look at that, fellas. There's my little daughter, Albadella, in there saying her prayers. I close the door so she won't hear it.
And now, dear Lord, please bless Mama and Daddy, our family, and all their friends. And I hope Uncle Kingfish enjoyed the New Year's card I sent him. Amen.
Andy, what I like
about how announced that John Lake is that he don't try to beat you over the head when he sells you something.
He don't have to. He just tells you the facts about new Rinso with Solium. The truth about that wonderful new Rinso is enough to make everybody want it.
Andy, you're right. Rinso is so marvelous that today more women use Rinso than any other wash day soap in the world. Only new Rinso contains Solium.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are two very happy fellows. Starting next Sunday and every Sunday thereafter, the Jack Benny Show, and what a show, will be on the Columbia Broadcasting System just ahead of us.
Yes, sir. Next Sunday you will get Jack Benny at the same time you always get him, but you'll get him on the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Listen to CBS next Sunday for Jack Benny and Amos and Andy right together. So in the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, a very happy New Year.
And that goes for everybody in the cast. See you next Sunday.
Stay tuned in for the adventures of Sam Spade, which follow immediately over many of these stations. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Howdy, folks. This is Will Sugarfoot Hutchins. You are now listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
We're back with you once again, folks. Hope you enjoyed Amos and Andy. That was the mysterious New Year's card from Sunday, December 26, 1948, originally over CBS. And a little note on that Amos and Andy. On the that same day that was broadcast, it was the date of Jack Benny's last NBC show. The following week, January 2, 1949, marked Jack Benny's first appearance on CBS as a lead-in for Amos and Andy. So, a little bit of information there. Folks, we are out of time. And we have some information to pass on to you, some reminders. There you go. Paul Whiteman and his orchestra, The Ghost Thereof. Playing our music there, our theme song, The Stumbling Foxtrot's what that's called. We want to remind you folks of that Chicken Man set you know you want when you have to have one. Just look for those silly dancing chickens on our homepage. And there's the Glowing Dial online store. Plenty of great gift ideas with the Glowing Dial logo. More are being designed as we speak. The Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com is a great place to go. Do your shopping. And you're helping us out here at the Glowing Dial by doing that. Don't forget to join our blog, our discussion list, and Facebook page and get all the latest Glowing Dial news. Celebrity birthdays, well, if you need more of those, our buddy Ron Sales has got you covered on his blog. Go to our webpage, glowingdial.com, click on links, and there it be. Jerry Hannigas is a good friend of the Glowing Dial. He has his audio restoration services to help you clean up those old recordings, transcription discs, or whatever you happen to have. He can help you out with that. Jerry also has his old-time radio network where you can hear the Glowing Dial and many other old-time radio shows in streaming audio. So check all those out. The Glowing Dial page is the internet home of the Glowing Dial, has been since 1997, has links for everything we just mentioned, and more. And one more great big thank you to Jerry Hannigas for his programming assistance on this and many episodes of The Glowing Dial. Thank you, Jerry. You do so much for us. We really appreciate it. Shout out to John over at OTRCat.com. Great place to get some MP3 shows on CD-ROM. He lets us use some of his information on various shows that we bring to you here. So thank you, John. Head on over to OTRCat.com. Tell him Big John from the Glowing Dial sent you on over there. And that's going to just about do it, except to wish everybody a very happy new year, a prosperous 2016. We hope it's going to be even better than this year was, or maybe you've had some problems this year. Hopefully things will get better for you. Hopefully things will get better for me. I could really use it. Greg, thank you once again, sir.
Yeah, that's what a way to start the year.
Yeah, exactly, for dropping over here. And before long, don't worry, it's going to be nice hot summer again for
you.
Oh,
yeah.
We just can't wait for
that. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, folks, we're going to have Stu with us probably on the next episode of The Glowing Dial, and that's still being put together at this point, so I can't really give you a preview. But we want you to tune in approximately 3 weeks' time. Just keep an eye on the website, and that'll tell you when things are going to premiere. So this is Big John and Greg saying keep a positive thought, keep looking up, think big, and we'll see you on the radio.